So basically, we've all found ourselves in this game. It's a setting, as I told you before, or as you may have read, it is dark space fantasy in which the great Emperor Zell, who is technically the savior of all mankind by paying for the project that caused them to leave Earth, which was dying, and move on to other planets. He now, even though he's a human, he still rules over 1,000 years later. And his laws are very strict. And the very first thing that he enacted was any crime will either be met with fine or death. The only exception is if there's actual evidence, like really substantial evidence, you didn't commit the crime, or if you actually have information that they want, and then afterward they'll kill you, or maybe you can broker a deal. So in that world, bounty hunters come to light, because you can't always, you know, in this world where there's millions and millions of possibilities and people and places, the iron grip of the Emperor can't be everywhere. And there's, unfortunately, because of that, a lot of corruption. And some might say that the bounty hunters are the only ones who can mete out real justice. And fortunately for you guys, you are going to be such people. However, it did not start out that way. The three of you originally were on the other side of the law. And through who knows what sort of decision-making that went on, they decided that they would enact an experiment. They wanted to find out, hey, if we, you know, stop wasting our resources and money on killing these people and not getting anything out of them because they owe us all this money and that, how about we try to make them actually work for society and work for us if they're capable? So they're going to give you guys basically a second chance at living by turning you into their own little workers. Although you technically have your own free will, every month, every 30 days that is, you either have to have completed 3 jobs at least, or you have to pay them a whole lot of money. And by a whole lot, I mean, let me see, that would be 100,000 piece, which would be technically 1,000 gold. Sorry, my math keeps going all over the place. But, so you're given this new opportunity, and you might look at it as either the low point of your character where you're being forced into servitude. Maybe it's the high point of your character where after all of this badness, you can finally get and do something useful in your life. And as we go along, we're going to begin questioning whether or not you're working for these people is actually benefiting you, or if it's slowly causing your condition or your morality to worsen over time. And one way or another, you'll be taken either up or down by wings of Ashen Crow. And just reference the the project that you're part of is known as the Ashen Crow Project. It's like to invoke the sort of image of a phoenix, except in this case, it's not a beautiful fiery bird that comes from the ashes, but a black and sort of, darn, the words just left my brain, a dark and sort of ambiguously moral creature, let's just say. because I can't come up with the word I originally had. And now that I've gone through that, I can finally show you guys sort of what we're working with here.
Cool.
So.
That music changed, though.
Yeah, because it's supposed to be when you're in transit music, like you're going, you know, just.
I like
just
it.
Yeah.
It's great, man.
So you see here, this is basically the map of the solar system as we know it. And there's quite a few options, and as you can see, there's some places that currently are not labeled. Those places are basically going to be made up as we go along. We get to sort of build them together so that not all of these things are, you know, set in stone right away. We all get some sort of agency with it. But there's information on a lot of the ones that are actually labeled. Some of them are labeled but don't actually have information either. And it's sort of the same sort of deal. And over time, as you know, questions arise and as we think of things, we can fill in the blanks.
Awesome.
Yep, the ones that are in the dead zone. I forgot that I didn't put the label that said what the dead zone was when I was doing this. But the dead zone, as you know, is basically where all radar and all sensors, all divination magic cannot penetrate. And for that reason, people don't like to go out there because it's very dangerous. You don't know where you're going to be going. Most people can't even tell if they're heading back toward the solar system or not. And that's actually where a lot of criminals like to go, mainly to these two planets that you can see, because the law can't see them. The law can't find them there. But there's plenty of dens within the solar system as well, as one might expect, because most people don't have access to space flight, but some people do. And down here, we find Tera, which is the old Earth. And as you can tell, it used to look like Mara, which is right next to it. But over time, its resources were taken bit by bit until it's basically just a wasteland now. And people, mostly humans, still live there. However, the conditions are extremely squalor, and pretty much anyone who thinks about going to Tera is in complete disgust at the thought. It's like saying, oh, I want to go in the middle of a desert where nobody lives for no reason, you know? I just like not being able to do things. But next door to Tera is Luna, which is the moon, which is currently inhabited by dwarves, almost exclusively dwarves. And they mine the planet, or moon, for metals and different resources. And they aren't very kind to people that aren't dwarves, but occasionally, you know, they'll have, like, people that ship there, or, you know, they might call in for some third-party advice and such. And then there's Mara, which is basically the Earth now, which is mostly, it's basically the hub planet where most people are. It has huge sprawling cities. It also has its own, you know, squalor places too, but for the most part, things are pretty nice there. And it has its own moon as well. And, the only other one that I want to showcase immediately is the Palace Imperial and the Beacon of Peace. The Palace Imperial is basically a giant golden space station that orbits around Nova, and pretty much nobody is allowed within I can't come up with the distance, but ooh, crap. Anyway, yeah, basically anyone around there is not allowed unless they're specifically given permission. And the Beacon of Peace is also, it's like basically a moon in orbit of Palace Imperial, and that's where all the major bankers, high aristocrats, and that are people that actually hired you came from there. And as far as that goes, it's about it. Basically, each one of these hexes that you see, for your ship as it is now, it takes a day to go through each of them. But as you upgrade your ship, or even if you buy a new one, it could be faster. And other than that, as far as that goes, there isn't too much else that I could think of. Let's see here. So, I suppose, does anyone have any questions about anything specific, like the setting or anything?
Don't think so.
Okay. So, I guess we can introduce the characters to start then. Just because when I put it down, this person came first. How about we introduce our little Warforged friend here. Tell us a little bit about your character.
I was originally a construct created to aid in the maintenance and repair of a spaceship. Over the years, after being given the commands to upgrade and survive, which I took literally as myself rather than just the ship, I have managed to give myself sentience in the last couple of years. I have a sniper rifle, and my name is the Synthetic Networked Individual Programmed for Efficient Repair, or for short, Sniper. Other than that, pretty standard maintenance robot.
Pretty standard, huh?
Yep, pretty standard. Just a big gun.
All right.
Is that weapon standard issue, soldier?
No.
So you're not close. Standard.
No, I'm standard. The weapon
is not.
Standard.
All right, now let us hear about a little bit about the gnome.
My name is Gelbin Mechatork. I am, as you can see, a gnome of the chaotic variety. I spent most of my days in the halls, in gambling halls, you know, wasting a lot of time and coins. One day I may have gone rather deep into the pocket of some people you don't want to be in the pocket of. As opposed to, you know, sticking around and, you know, doing what I had to do to work off the money or pay on back, I slipped town. What followed that was some, quite a few attempts at capturing me, which, you know, pretty much all failed. At some point, though, I got relatively bored with the whole cat and mouse game and, you know, decided that, why not just let them catch me? It could be interesting. You know, let them catch me. It wasn't until that moment that he kind of realized that maybe he was bored with this life. You know, he knows the rules. He knows that breaking the law is pretty much death, but, you know, I'm assuming they then approached him with this offer, and he decided that maybe life was going to get a little more interesting.
Yeah, we'll do the introduction.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll do that.
Oh, then that has not happened yet. Just kidding. Just kidding.
All right. Now, let's introduce Ashen, our friend.
Yes, Mareal is... Well, he's originally from Celestia, and a sort of darkness has come over him, and nonetheless, he's been shunned away from where he once was, and has now been traveling across the cosmos, learning a lot, hoping always to try and redeem himself and find his place. He's of course a golden child, a knight of the stars, which means that although he's just a mere medium-sized humanoid, he also brings with him a rather large piece of armor that he gets inside and kicks some ass with. If you're on the wrong side of the law and he's after you, you better run really quickly.
That's for sure. Alright. So, let me see if there's anything else specific I wanted to bring up really quick. But yeah, I did have a couple questions to start off with. Because we have the spaceship that you're going to have pretty soon, I was wondering, did you guys at all want to focus on the ship as like an element in the game, or did you just sort of want it literally as a vehicle to get where you want? Because if you guys want to like get into upgrading and like actually piloting it, you know, I can make up some rules for if you get into mid-space battles, or could also add in stuff that you could purchase for the ship specifically, or a new ship even.
I think, I don't know about these guys, but I would personally love to have a whole bunch of new mechanics involving ships and stuff. That would be sweet.
I'm completely fine with it.
I'm all about it. I mean, I've made my character, so I'm all about it.
Cool. I can pilot too. I think I took the proficiency, so it, you know, in emergency situations, we can but I would love to build, like, you know, spend our money building up our ship and making it better, you know, getting more efficient at doing these jobs, right?
Try not to gamble all of our money away. No promises.
All your money away.
Well, you know, what's yours is mine, and what's mine is mine.
Gambling's illegal in this sector. I'll have you know, Gelbin. Aren't actually wagering bets, are you? I'll stare at you with my eyes
no,
burning bright.
No.
Good.
Me? Never.
Lord Zell forbade gambling long ago.
Yeah.
Well, actually, he's all for gambling. As
probably.
Cheap.
Only if it's sanctioned by him.
Yeah.
You're not telling me these are sanctioned tables, are they?
I always go to only the most sanctioned.
Very, very well then. That checks out.
That checks out, please.
All right. So I can see you guys are eager to get into things. So I suppose I should hurry up and jump in. Let me see here. Let me find the right music. Everybody, I want you. You should be able to see the playing cards. I want you to draw one of those if you can. I don't know if I said it that players can draw them.
Just the playing card?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let me see.
Just one, two, okay.
I don't know what's in your hand.
Yeah. Secret.
Yeah, if you could, now reveal them. I'll just slap them down on the table in front of us. Wow. Two people with fives. And a two. So, the people who got the fives. Draw again and put down a new card on top. Oh my god. I think you guys might be okay, because I'm having you do this to see who goes first. Maybe both of you are in the same place at the same time.
It's meant to be. Because
I think that's fate when you get the same one twice.
Double double.
So I want you two to think, in what scenario, what place might you both be at the same time? Maybe you're both even temporarily imprisoned. Which is, again, it's very rare to go to prison and not, unless like you have specific information, but it's possible that they might have imprisoned you to hold you for this project specifically. Just try to think together, I guess, where you both might be when you are asked, or rather, given the ultimatum to join. In other words,
made you an offer you can't refuse.
I mean, prison works all right for me. I'd probably either be, it could also be like in a some kind of docking type area, I would suppose, like where you would land on certain planets, or if your character would ever be anywhere that games of chance are played.
Well, I mean, my character basically, I'm thinking if my character was to be in trouble, it was most likely that he was more or less a martyr for something that happened. He's not necessarily guilty 100%. So, like, his crew got killed and they blamed him for murdering the whole crew kind of thing. They're like, oh, the robot did it. He's the only one that survived. So, if we were in some sort of prison thing,
so prison would probably make more sense than anywhere.
I don't feel like I'd probably be anywhere gambling.
You wouldn't run or anything to them. You'd probably report it and then be like, but I didn't do it. Please.
Yeah, most likely. I am good. Yeah. Lawfully.
And just for reference, and so that we all know, out of character, what were you guys imprisoned for exactly?
Like I said, I think mine is most likely that the exact thing is basically someone murdered an entire crew of people, unknown to me, and I was the sole survivor of that crew. And I have sentience, so I decided, well, I mean, he's actually alive, so we'll charge him with murder. Even though it wasn't me who actually killed everyone.
I mean, in these times, like I said, there's lots of corruption. Maybe they just wanted to be done with the case already. And they're like, yeah, just say that he did it. No one cares anyway.
He's just a warforged.
All right. So.
Go ahead.
I want both of you now to draw from the top deck for me. Just drag and drop it onto the kind of the thing.
I don't think that worked when I did it. So I'll just draw one. Drag it up. Mine. The sun. Praise the sun!
Alright. So, you guys have a choice. And since you're both together, which card do you think would be better? The sun or the high priestess?
I mean, the sun's worshipped in this place. That sounds like a good guess to me.
Praise the sun. As I've already.
Praise the sun indeed. All right, give me one moment then.
It was the wrong call. We're all dead. We're both dead. Wrong call.
Well, I mean, you could.
We're sort of victim right now.
Put on your new kick. Oh no.
My character's the version 2 of this character.
Me too.
I just need to upload this file really quick. So you're both sitting around in your cells, spending time as you might be, probably in the same exact cells as each other, because they're not used to having people here, and even though they have tons of cells, they're like, fuck it, just throw them in the same cell. And they actually probably don't have a lot of cells, so that's probably the main reason. But anyways, regardless, you are wasting your time, maybe... you might have, by the way, if you could change your names in-game to your character names, it'll help me remember them a lot quicker. But, so you're both sitting in your cell, and suddenly a man comes walking up to the bars. He's wearing a golden mask, which you can tell when you look at it immediately that it is real gold, something that is never seen by anybody, unless you're like seeing it from a distance as you fly by the Palace Imperial. And he's wearing a illustrious red robe, and the mask sort of has a protrusion on the front, a long proboscis, and it has little slots for eyes, but you can't really see behind them. And behind him, you hear a sort of clanking, and it's coming closer and closer as he stares at you.
My, my, we have two lost birds, don't we?
You hear it coming from behind the mask.
It's about time you showed up. I was starting to get really bored.
And if either of you would like, you can make a history check to know anything about this person that you're seeing.
Oh, that's religion.
Well, it's probably the same.
Oh, I see. Yeah, it is, but I see the dice is on this side. Awkward.
But, Sniper, you, one way or another, might have learned that this is the garb of... Let me keep this music going, so it's not just flat. This is the garb of the Peacekeepers, people who normally can be found in the Beacon of Peace, and it's extremely rare to see one in person unless there's some sort of large or important transaction being made. So you seeing this person here would have great significance. And they say,
oh, so you've been expecting me then. I would like to give you a proposition, a way out of this, because as you know, you're not going to stay in prison for long. For your crimes soon, you will be executed unless you take this deal. We need bodies. We need people to work for us. We have a special project going on, the Ashen Crow Project, to bring lost birds like you into fame and glory as bounty hunters for us. How does that sound?
By my calculations, your deal sounds as if it is the only route to go.
Your calculations are most correct. And as he says this, see a rather imposing figure step in behind him.
Jesus Christ.
They stand at about 10 feet tall with the spikes on their back, standing another 2 or so feet up, sort of scraping across the ceiling as he walks forward. And anyone who knows anything at all about the government would know that this is one of the Palace Imperial's personal paladins. And again, seeing one of them here would be of extreme significance. You feel that they pretty much, they don't even just want to make it so that you take the deal, but that you can't escape if you try to. And he doesn't even say anything as he stands there behind the masked man, glaring at you with, again, pure golden armor. Real gold. Everything that he's wearing just glimmers.
It's an expensive outfit.
I'm gonna look at the guy in the gold mask and just say, now you've got my interest.
I'm glad. In that case, I would like you to sign this contract.
And he sort of very nonchalantly slides two pieces of paper, actually two stacks of paper, underneath the bars. And then he slides under an inkwell and a feather to each of you. And he says, we're going to make this official. Feel free to read through, but I think you understand that whatever's in there will be better than what you have now.
I've already signed it and I'm sliding it back.
I'm paging through it. and then as he says that, I'm flipped to wherever the sign is. Very robotically sign the print my last name.
Stamp it.
Yes, I don't use the inkwell, I just stamp it. Little thing pops out of my palm.
So as a addendum to what I said earlier, since you read it, you would know that actually, essentially, you would require to pay them 10,000 gold at the end of a month if you don't complete your job. And if you can't pay them immediately, then not only are you dead, but everybody that could possibly be colluding with you is also dead.
Damn.
Essentially, they're trying to force you into this one way or another, so that now if you're taking this, you're actually roping in any friends and family that you have, too. Since you were going to die anyway, you know, you don't have much motivation once, you know, you realize you're going to die again. But, and once you finally finish signing, the paladin turns his back to you. You see spread across his back is hundreds of spikes and spines in the form of the sun. And he just begins to walk away with loud thuds. You see that where he walked, there's indentations in the floor. And the peacekeeper... Oops, sorry. Are you saying something?
Nope.
You can't see it, but you feel sort of grin as he chuckles. You're very smart. There's been a few that have disagreed, and I'm sure you realize that the penalty is more harsh, should you say so. I will see you in 1 week. I'm Mara. And basically he leaves, and as you also leave, you are given the information, the exact coordinates where they're going to be, where you can meet up.
Sounds good. Write those down in my brain.
And you are handed over all of your goods that were confiscated from you when you came into the prison. All right, now
kiss
for
my revolvers. Welcome home, babies.
Now for how would your name be pronounced, Mark?
Mareal.
Mareal.
Mm-hmm.
And if you would like to draw a card from the tarot deck as well.
I'll just drag it right to the top here. The star.
Yeah, I think you have to, the trick is you go to the top where the card's, like, poking out, and then you grab it and drag it. It might only be something the DM can do, though.
Oh, yeah, when I drag mouse over the top, it says that.
Yeah, I did it, so it should be there.
All right, the star. One moment. So while I'm thinking about this, think about where it is you would be when your crime comes to full fruition, or I guess also what your crime was, and where you would be when you're approached.
Well, what I'm thinking is that my crime was while I was enforcing the law at some local system somewhere, I must have been overzealous in my task. Nonetheless, the person that I ended up killing somehow through the bureaucracy, probably through somebody setting me up or whatnot, I was charged with murder for that. And, having been now completely and utterly disgraced, I would also be sent to jail. I suppose this probably would have happened, after I was kicked out of Celestia, somewhere in my travels as I was working as some sort of local enforcer. Probably at Mara, so I probably would have been arrested at my home, and I probably would have been waiting for them to come and take me away, willingly going to jail. As I served, waited there, and was eventually went through my court proceedings, it was pretty apparent that I was going to be sent right to the prisons. I would be at home, waiting to get arrested.
All right. So, as you're sitting there waiting, you hear a sound from outside that it's almost like a huge explosion right outside your door, and a loud impact, and you see a flash of bluish light. And moments later, you hear a very light and polite knock at the door.
Come in. It's unlocked.
And the door slides open very carefully, and you see outside pretty much the entire ground is desolated, pitch black, as they begin to walk inside. And you see, again, same sort of figure from before, a man in red robes and with a golden mask. And since you seem to be sort of tied in the bureaucracy a bit, perhaps you would know immediately the kind of person that this is. It's a pleasure to make your acquaintance. I've heard so much about you. So much about your crime. So much about that peculiar trait of yours.
I'll just have a stonewall look expression on my face. Like as if my face hasn't changed since the day I've been arrested. I'm just sitting there with that same grim look, waiting it out.
Oh. I do love people like you. And he doesn't even sort of turn around, but his body turns very slightly, and he waves an arm. And as he does so, a very large figure begins to force their way through the door behind them. A man sort of filtering bluish light in an armor very similar to yours, except his is a sort of whitish gold in color, It's pure white gold. He walks in with a shield on his arm emblazoned with hundreds of stars, and he sort of stares at you with a look that sort of mimics your own. And the man with the mask sort of chuckles again. You know what the sentence is for your crime traditionally, but we come with a proposal, one that I think you would enjoy.
My head's going to turn slightly towards the man in the armor, very slightly. And then I will turn my gaze towards the figure in the robe. What's your offer?
First, you don't die, if you agree. Second, is you will join us as a special member of our project, known as the Ashen Crow. We desire individuals such as yourself with exceptional talents and with the know-how and especially the ability to kill. We want you to work as bounty hunters for us.
As he says those words, my eyes will begin to glow white with energy again, and I will slowly begin to rise to my knees and then to my feet, standing tall.
The figure behind him seems to tense up just slightly, and the blue flames burn more brightly.
I'll turn back and stare at this figure in the armor, dead in the face, as I say, I accept your offer.
Very good. You're a very intelligent man, I can tell. Just sign this contract. We'll meet you on Mara in a couple days. He sort of hands you a stack of paper and inkwell as he did to the others.
Without even like looking, still staring at this golden child paladin in the face, I am going to sign the paperwork and hand it back to him.
You see the flames die down, and the figure sort of gives a nod of their head without saying a word. And then the masked man looks over the paper just to make sure that you actually signed it. And then you hear another soft chuckle. I'm very glad we could come to an agreement and not to blows. I look forward to your cooperation in the future. And he turns around and walks out.
I'll just be standing there, staring down at the cell floor, eyes glowing white.
Alright, and then you're, moments later, you're released from your cell and given all of your things once again. And now we can have everybody come up together. So before that, I'll just do it first. And let me just get some music real quick. All right, so all of you arrive at the same location, a rather discreet hangar on Mara's surface, someplace near the ocean. And there aren't very many people hanging around there. It seems like they didn't want a huge spectacle, but let me draw a card this time. Okay. You arrive probably roughly at the same time as each other. And in the hangar, you see the a similar robed man. But this time you could tell that it's a different one, considering the mask has horns instead of a proboscis. And they look slightly taller. And they sort of beckon you over to the center of the hangar.
I'll slowly walk over. I guess if the other ones are there, I'll be looking at them, sort of sizing them up a little bit. Right now, I'm just in my normal traveler's cloak with a bit of a leather armor underneath.
I'll just ping you to where you guys are. Okay, so I guess you all come together then?
Yes. Why not? Seems like something interesting could happen if I actually listen to this guy.
I'm glad you all arrived, because it would have been a horrible death for you otherwise.
You're from behind the mask.
I was looking forward to it.
I've been promised a lot of those.
You silly child. Well, I'm sure you read your contracts and you understand why you're here. You have become tools of the palace, as it were. Now, obviously, well, maybe not so obviously, maybe some of you don't get it. These other men you see here are going to be in the same project as you, but not just that. You are all going to be working together from now on. Isn't that lovely? Yes, dramatic music and all. I would like for you to get to know one another and learn your strengths and weaknesses to better work together. Or don't and die. I don't really care either way. Now, obviously, if we're going to have you working together, you need some place to work as your command. Preferably a mobile one, right?
That would be better. Yeah.
Sure, why not?
Well, it just so happens that we're going to be kind enough as to provide you with your very own ship. Now, of course, it's going to be the lowest of the lowest of models. Nothing extravagant at all. In fact, it's probably falling apart. But you get it for free, or for now it's free. You have to pay for any repairs and any fuel, and also you're going to be owing us money in return as you gain money, but don't worry about that right now. First, I would like for you to pick out which one you would like in this hangar.
Let me get some better music to use for this.
Some ship picking music?
Some ship picking music? What does that sound like?
I don't know.
It's got a banjo with like an electric guitar and beatboxing.
Cowbell.
Yeah, and cowbell. Cowbell. And cowbell. Everything's got cowbell. And beatboxing. Cowbell.
That's not
their
own.
Yeah. Yeah.
Alright, so. First, he shows you a really rusty but sort of out there design. A long ship that perhaps evokes the sort of sailing ships of old. While it doesn't actually have sails, it has long spokes that look like they're meant for sails. And it's a lot longer than it is wide, so you think the interior is probably pretty cramped. Then there's a slightly larger ship with a much larger engine to it. Looks more like a modern day spaceship. Then there's this particular model sort of has two extensions on the side, which are mainly used for mounting cannons, but cannons appear to have rusted off. A more stealth looking vehicle. It seems to be a loaner from the military, actually. This one, which pretty much only looks like a rocket more than an actual ship. You can't really tell unless you know a lot about ship design that it has fins or ways to actually propel itself other than forward. And finally, there is this rusted old model at the end that is larger than the others, even though it looks smaller in scale. And it has a place for a very large cannon in the front and three thrusters in the back.
I'm probably going to be looking straight at the old, big, rusty one and sort of going, it could have potential.
Which one looks the most likely to have malfunctions and failures?
Probably that one.
That's probably the same one I'm looking at.
It's a fixer-upper, but...
chance!
So much square footage!
Well, it's nowhere near as cramped as that one, I'm gonna say, pointing back towards the first one that we looked at.
Nothing's really cramped for me.
That's a bigger ship, too.
Does it look like most of the the damage on the exterior is pretty much cosmetic? Like, it's not like we're gonna go into space and the whole thing's just gonna explode kind of damage?
Yeah, it looks like total crap, and a lot of the, there's pretty much no paint left. But, you could tell that it's definitely flyable. They also wouldn't give you one that literally you're gonna die as soon as you enter space in.
We don't know that.
Which one looks like it could be modified and improved the most?
I mean, if you're looking for modified the most, it'd probably be that one also.
Well, because we could fit the most turrets on it, right?
Yeah, you could probably... it doesn't have room for a lot of guns itself. It only has room for the one cannon, but you probably could add turrets to it. But just for reference, this one probably looks like the fastest, like in terms of... Oh, if you're cool. In a race against
top
somebody.
Out speed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Straight you're still away, gonna yeah. take one day to move the same amount of hexes, but if you had to get somewhere really fast within an area, you'd get there using that.
That's
this
nice.
One looks like it has the most firepower. This one looks like it's actually pretty good at stealth. This one's pretty much average in every way. And this one you're not really sure about it.
Alright guys, what do you think? You really like that one, don't you?
I got my vote for the one that has the highest.
Now I'm torn, you know, like for one, we got the big gamble over here of this thing looking bad, but we have a mystery over here.
Mystery's cool.
So,
one more thing too. I'm just gonna throw it out here, but this one's got stealth, and if Star Wars has taught me anything, stealth trumps everything. You know. You usually come up to a situation with bigger firepowers involved, and stealth is usually the best option in those situations.
Star Wars has also taught me the Millennium Falcon is just a rust bucket.
It's true.
I
may not look like much, but it's got where it counts, huh, kid?
Because this one is the largest one, it also means it would have the worst armor class.
Yeah, it'd be very so easy to hit. Yeah, just get slammed on. All right, Alex, did you have your heart set on any particular one? I want to hear your opinion. That one too, eh? Yeah. Oh my god. I'm going to vote that one too. So
I think that's the way me as a player, I'm with you on the stealth.
Mhm. Yeah.
But like as a character, I'm like
definitely
really,
as a character I'm like, the same.
Hey, you know, that thing looks like it could be a lot of fun.
It needs some work, but there's a lot of potential there. It'll be like we'll start walking and getting closer to it and really starting to inspect it. She said it's got three thrusters.
Yeah. Needs it for all that bulk.
How much cargo space are we talking about?
That one would probably have about tied with this one for cargo space.
Okay. As long as there's enough space, I want to be able
this
to.
This one would actually have the worst cargo space.
I want to be able to build like a prison inside there so that we could. You know, if we ever took any prisoners, we could put them inside of there and they would be very secure. That's probably got the most, second most space to deal with. The other one's got, but we could probably fit a, enough for a hold, maybe a large or huge sized creature.
Yeah, there's definitely more than enough room for that. Nice. I will say, pretty much all of these have room for a total. They could house up to 8 people in the bunks.
Oh, cool.
They're classified as giant class ships, and just so that you know, the order goes kobold, which is 1 person, owlbear, which is 2 to 5, then giant, which is up to 10, mm-hmm. and then there's dragon, which is large, then there's Tarrasque, and then god.
Nice. Gonna get me a god ship, guys.
Just for reference, the Palace Imperial is considered a god class ship.
Oh, I see.
We'll work on it. That's gonna take some time. We'll work on it.
We could just upgrade this one to a god class.
Yeah, you just add a couple of gold, and then yeah.
Just add other ships to this ship, and we'll be fine.
Oh, it's gonna be like Power Rangers.
Yes.
All right, so you got your ship decided, and the man's sort of rubbing his hands together as you're talking about it. He seems to be very pleased that this is what you chose. I thought that's what you would pick when you saw it. Now, here are the keys. And he just nonchalantly tosses it at one of you. And it has a tank of gas, but you will have to refuel it the next time it runs out, and well, we'll be keeping tabs on you, and we hope to hear from you, or not, then you'll die. Either way works. Oh yeah, just want to remind you, by the way, it isn't illegal to kill bounty hunters if they're trying to catch you, so keep that in mind.
Oh, yeah.
Much more fun.
Yes, it's only illegal if they're political officials like the police, but you know how it goes. Nobody, if someone dies as a bounty hunter trying to catch the bounty, they just failed at their job. Huh. Well, with all that said, goodbye. And if you don't have anything else to say, he just waves his hands in the air, and immediately he disappears in a flash of gold.
Real quick, Alex, because I don't think it actually... does anybody know how much the Tinker tool set costs?
I think it might have been 100 gold, but let me look.
I don't actually see it in the player's handbook. I just remembered I needed to have one. So that was quick.
The pack's not in there. Yeah, hold on.
Unless I'm just missing it completely.
50 gold.
Here it is. I did just completely miss it.
Yeah, 50 gold and it's 10 pounds.
Thank you. I did just completely miss it. Thought it was all alphabetical, not changing.
Hey, you'd think that would be. All right. So, you guys now have your own ship.
Awesome.
Let me delete all these other ones.
For garbage anyway.
This is so cool.
Now let me put it on the map where you guys are too.
I got a data pad out already writing up the upgrades.
I've got the ship handout here. It's got a character sheet too, so...
Yep, I'll have to fill in with the specifics for this ship, but for now, just
AC 10, hit points 100, speed 80, fly 1 hex. This is fucking awesome. This is so cool.
Got our own ship. Yeah. It's as big as the planet. I'm aware it's not actually that big.
Just to represent where you guys are at right now. And so... You get yourselves settled in. Wanted to wait until you decided what kind of ship it was to actually find a map for the interior, but I'm going to start looking. But for now, you guys can imagine basically the inside looks however you want, but there's two seats up front for the captain seat. And something that if you read in the document is that every ship would be equipped with an ArcNet device, which is basically like a phone, except not. In this case, you would get to decide what your ArcNet device looks like. It could be something mystical, like a pool of water that you see images in, or that you hear things out of. Could be like a screen that you can see things from. It's up to you to decide what that looks like.
I don't know why I thought of it, but could do like a mirror.
Yeah, I was thinking mirror too, actually.
I don't know why that popped into my head. So again.
These calls are collect, though, correct? You got to pay for the calls?
Yes, you actually do. In fact, it's actually 100 piece per call that you make. Unless you had a wizard, and then it would have been free.
It could have been a old telephone booth in there. You have to put a coin in, and then it opens up.
Literally a booth, too.
That would be hilarious. That would be hilarious.
But it still has the mirror.
Yeah, you just walk into the phone booth.
Or you gotta put a coin in there and like pull the crank, and then the current slides back and then shows the mirror. And the current slides closed when like your allotted time is up or something like that.
I like the phone. I have to admit, I do like the phone. Because it's hilarious. It's like the old phone booth, and you walk in, and you're just like...
You know, like jimmy the door open and like put the coin in. Hello?
Yeah, that's so good. We wouldn't be able to receive images directly through the phone, but it would be the funniest one. Mirror's really cool too, though. That's what I was thinking immediately.
So it could be that, like you said, there's a mirror in the booth where you can see and project images from.
It's just that the mirror's inside of a phone.
Yeah, that's true. The phone's there because the mirror was a great design, but it didn't have audio, right? And then the phone's there to make the audio work. Yeah, it's beautiful. It's beautiful. I love it.
Perfect.
It's a phone booth with a mirror in it.
You can access from it. There isn't a very sophisticated... There is the ArcNet, which is also, in addition to being like a phone... It's also a little bit like the internet, but it's not very sophisticated. There isn't really like a Google and, you know, hundreds of websites and stuff, because it actually takes a lot of money and magic to be able to power one of these things. But one of the basic things that you gain is access to, let me make sure, the job board. Now, there's hundreds and hundreds of jobs posted here because they come from all over the place, but you can list through based on your location and your level of expertise. There's also tons of jobs that you guys can't take yet because nobody knows you well enough to accept you into the job. So right now, looking at your current situation, this is basically what you can find.
So, just curious, is the grumble mining, and the Tera allied guard supposed to be the same one? Or was that just a typo?
The location?
No, they both say track down the hideout of the red band.
Oh crap, I forgot to...
So I didn't know if like it was like...
Sorry.
One side wanted it for one reason and another side wanted her, you know, kind of thing. And
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I was thinking you could cash it in one side or the other, but whoever you take it to alive, right, the other side's gonna be like...
Just gonna try and take you down or something, you
exactly.
know, or maybe there's opposition, so that's what I wanted to...
That's what I was thinking it was too, is like, you know, you capture the guy, but then it's like, you know, do you take it back to this country or this country, huge exterminate pests.
If we had our jail cell already, this would be perfect. Capture him alive, no problem.
Look at this, right here. Join the force today. Great Emperor Zell is imploring us, I'll say, holding it, like pointing at it. We can do this.
We can join
the government.
The average income is 100 piece a month, so that, not a month, it's actually 100 piece a week. So that amount is actually a lot for somebody. And by the way, if it gets annoying to you to call it piece or trying to figure out the conversion, we can just keep calling it gold if you want. It's just, I thought it worked for the setting more since there isn't any gold pieces.
Gold is rare.
I like it. I think it's really cool that we call it this. It'll take some getting used to, but I think it really adds flavor, so. Yeah, high numbers like that imply gold, inflation, so it's beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, it's cool.
That was the other thing, is that I wanted it to sound like it's actually a whole ton of inflated cash.
Yeah, it's really good. I think it adds a neat flavor to it, so.
So what I'm hearing is it sounds like a sketchy posting.
Sketchy? So. There's nothing sketchy about Great Emperor Zell, I'll say it. With my eyes, like, burning with that zealous fervor.
While sitting there spinning one of the revolver, I don't even know what you would call it, but the part of the revolver that revolves. Sitting there spinning that.
Chamber,
yeah, sure. That's a good word for it. It is the word for it. So, while sitting there spinning that, I'd probably say, aren't we technically already part of his force after we signed that contract?
Technically you are, although you're not part of the military, which is what this would be an advertisement for. And you know that.
Oh, these wouldn't count as jobs, though, would it?
It is an actual advertisement and not like a job.
So it doesn't actually count as a job, does it?
No. Technically not. I just thought it would be cool to have it on there.
I'm gonna be like,
it wasn't in a line, or yeah.
I'm definitely gonna be the one that's gonna be super interested in that. And every time we come back to the job board, he's gonna be the guy that's gonna try and convince you every time, and you guys have to convince him of something else instead. I'm just gonna look back. I'm like, Great Emperor Zell, I can serve you once again. Staring off into the distant cosmos with my eyes burning. Yes. What other jobs are there?
Well, as you can see, there is the job to apprehend the Red Band. The location is Tera. And again, pretty much the idea of going to Tera sickens most people. Maybe it doesn't sicken your characters exactly. Maybe you're used to it. But basically, it would be like you're going to the slums. Not even just some bad slums, but literally people living in garbage.
Interesting. Well, the thing is, my character... Look, so we have access to the reward and all this stuff. My character is probably looking at Apprehend the Red Band as it has the highest reward. Argo, probably the highest risk.
Yep, you would know that typically you get paid more for a riskier job. Sometimes they post them and they're not worth, once you actually experience it, what it's posted for, or that it's overinflated, or that you can't complete the job because it's too difficult. Sometimes the quick and the low price ones are even easier than they appear.
I'll say good news, the lowest reward one is also on the same planet, so if we go to that planet, if nothing else, we could go for the other one.
Apprehend some bandits, you say? Looking over.
Yeah, we gotta work our way up to prove that we're truly, truly capable of joining.
Tera, that's a real shithole.
I've been in worse.
Nobody likes going there.
Well, not maybe not worse, but
there's no worse than Tera. But and you're right, that is the most pay.
I want you guys to make me either history or nature checks really quick.
And we would be serving justice. Would you say history or nature checks?
Yeah, either one works.
Is that right?
Five.
It's all right, I got a two.
All right, so Sniper... You don't know too much, but you do know that it's actually kind of strange when you look at this that it's actually talking about bringing supplies from Tera to Luna, because normally the dwarves don't like people from other planets, and when they do get their supplies, they don't usually get it from Tera because there's not really anything down there. So it's possible that either there's somebody very lucrative hiding on Tera that's behind this job, or might be something else behind it.
Then I'll relay to the crew. There's something fishy about this one.
Even better, got a little mystery on our hands. Besides the fact that it's a 2-for-1.
I like where this is going. Shall we head to Tera and investigate? I'll kind of give a smile at Gelbin as we're kind of like saying the same words at the same time.
I'll give you a grin back.
We'll both look over towards S.N.I.P.E.R. as if for their approval.
And I'll begin charting a course.
Yeah!
Alright, so as you input the coordinates for Tera, who is it that you contact first to tell them that you're doing the job?
Yeah, and who should be the face of this operation?
Well, who has a charisma? Because I don't.
Well, I'll pull my hood down. I do have 16 charisma. Fairly handsome. But I'm more about intimidating than probably persuading.
I don't have a face.
I have 14 in that charisma.
But are you persuasive?
I'm pretty persuasive. I can talk some people into some things.
Alright, why don't you... I'll just stand silently behind you and, like, stare.
Yeah, if I start floundering, you know.
Yeah.
Coming for the save.
There you go. All so, right. I guess you're gonna call, and yeah, like he said, who should we call first? By the way, I want to say awesome music. This is some great music.
Yeah. Let's call the red band one, or,
Do we have a step stool in here? How else are you gonna see through that?
Probably a step stool.
Yeah. Well, Pat, put some boxes underneath them or something.
So I'll walk in. How much money was it to use the thing?
100 piece.
100? Alright, well, that's... in what?
Now, that's per gold? Day, by the way, not per call.
Okay, well, I'll just go ahead and minus 1 gold then. Easy. So I still have mine in gold. I'll convert it at some point.
There's not any rush.
So, I suppose. So we're calling the people who posted the jobs is what we're doing, basically. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. To learn, you know, basically what information they have.
Now here's
know that you're actually do the job.
Now, yeah, just to confirm some stuff. You did you say there were other groups out there doing the same jobs kind of thing while we are?
Yes, you would have actually learned that. Your group is not entirely unique. There's probably at least 12 other groups that are doing the same thing.
So I'm going to think for a second. Like, now, do we want to call the harder one first, or do you think someone will try and swoop in on that easy one?
I didn't mention that, but you actually brought it up for me to remind me. Some jobs might get taken by other people when you don't take them.
Yeah, that's what I figured, so that's what I'm asking the group.
Well, we'll be calling them both. I say call the larger pay job first.
Sounds
and then
good to me.
Go from there.
And I'll dial them up.
They don't have to know that we've accepted more than one job, so...
Exactly.
It's true.
Just gotta be careful on as far as time tables.
Yeah, so you're calling the Tera Allied Guard then?
Yep.
Alright. Get some more fitting music for this.
Where are we?
Is this the one? I think this is my... Might hear some weird music for a second. I threw that one out. I will have my music figured out next time. I've just been trying to build up the library right now.
No worries. Dark Souls music sounded like there. Walking to
I do have license. Some, but that was from something else.
I just reminded me of it. Walking to a boss room, spoopy music starts playing, and then you die. Dark Souls!
Alright, so you call up the Tera Allied Guard, which is basically the police force that they don't really, as far as you know, actually go down to Tera very often, but they're basically responsible for taking care of any crime that happens to it. They don't really do their job often, which is usually where you guys come in, because they're lazy, as far as everybody knows, pretty much everybody knows. And they don't like to actually work. All they do is figure out what people are complaining about and then tell other people to take care of it.
I like their style.
So you call up, and on the screen appears the image of this very large, rotund man sitting back in a chair, staring at a screen that's not the screen that you're looking at, and sort of munching on something. And he doesn't even seem to notice you're there.
Oh boy. Excuse me, good sir.
You see an eye just sort of turn toward you very slightly.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what's this about?
Well, we're calling for the job you have posted here.
Which one? You're here to, take care of the, what is it, the Black Hand?
The Red Band.
Oh, the Red Band, oh. Those ones are more annoying. Yeah. Yeah, you should take care of those ones,
Now, if you have additional work for us to take care of the Black Hand as well.
Well, I mean, League of Assassins going around, it's just annoying. I mean, I think it's above your pay grade, though. You don't look... sort of looks you over and he notices all the rust in the background. You don't look like the kind of guy who does those jobs. But, the red band, yeah, they've been sort of menacing people. You know, not even really menacing as much as annoying us. They're smugglers and they keep hiding out in Tera because I think it's easy.
And who wants to go to Tera, right? Let's be honest.
Exactly. Nobody looks for them there. And that's why you're going to look for them. Now, all we really know about them is one of the cities that supposedly they show up in every now and then. When they aren't hiding, which they seem to be doing a lot, they're wearing a red clothing, red scarves, mostly. And they like to carry lots of guns. And so people of Tera, they usually don't mess with them because the citizens, well, they don't have weapons.
Sounds just the most original bandit crew I've ever heard of.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'll give you the coordinates to that city and, you got about, well, I mean, you're not the only ones that are looking for them, but, I mean, just try to find them, you know, bring them back. Oh, yeah, we wanted the leader because we needed to figure out the higher-ups wanted to ask him some questions about who he's smuggling to and from. I don't know. You can kill him if you want, but they're offering more money.
I'm pretty sure we all here, all of us here, like more money. I'll probably look over to to Mareal and gauge his reaction about that.
While this is going on, the ship is probably going into orbit for the first time, and the entire thing begins to violently shake.
Oh, God.
I'll try and keep my composure. Look down at towards Gelbin, and I'll say... I look back towards the mirror screen, and ask him, how do I identify the leader?
You have to talk into the receiving of the phone, and I'll hold the phone
like to my face, but like directly to my face, so as if the top part that should be at my ear is now on my forehead, and the other part is on my mouth. As if I have no idea how to use a phone. I've never used one before ever, and I'll say it with it mashed into my face.
How do we identify the leader?
I'll just take the phone back. Give you a little thumbs up. Good job.
They say that the leader is, what are they called? The Hobgoblin? Yeah, one of those guys. And he wears some really bright red armor with spikes in it. It's pretty hard not to see him. This is a pain in my ass. I'll send over a picture that people say that he looks like. I mean, you'll probably know when you see him.
He will be vanquished.
You see, suddenly a picture pops up on the screen. Let me grab it. I guess, look at my old photos.
I'll look back at Sniper and say, you should be receiving coordinates to a city on Tera.
And indeed, they sort of bloop up next to you on the panels.
I'm gonna log those.
Probably be a little more concerned with the massive shaking of the ship, but you know it's fine.
The ship's shaking, yeah. You hear me shouting, this is all calculated, do not worry. That went to our left engine, don't worry, it's back.
There went the left engine, oh, it's back, we're okay.
It was gonna be the running joke, right?
Pieces randomly going bad and coming back.
As I stare down at the picture, my eyes will glow bright, bright, bright white, and then there'll be a flash of blackness as they puff out and go back to a normal glow.
That's one ugly fella. Yeesh. Well, we'll get him for you. Don't worry about it, you know, it'll...
One more question.
Oh, wait.
Hurry up.
What are his crimes?
Smuggling, conspiracy for murder, eluding the police, you know, the normal stuff.
This is a lot familiar, man.
He will be brought to justice.
We'll note, by the way, that actually was not charged with murder, just conspiracy to murder.
Mm-hmm. I will note that.
Well,
as far as everyone else goes, orders are you're free to kill them because, you know, their crimes are beyond fee. Worthless to society.
Well, alrighty then. Well, sir, you have been a great help, and I can tell that you have much more important things to get back to.
And as you say that, the screen goes sarcasm.
Just gonna put it down. All right, well, that guy was...
And the curtain closes.
The real customer, the curtain closes.
It would appear that he hung up early on you.
Yeah. Yeah, he did. By the way, I'm gonna show you how to hold a phone real quick. That way you can hear what he says, and then, you know, he can understand you, because it's not...
This is some seriously outdated technology.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, look at the ship.
We're both, by the way, cramped into us, like, yeah. Into a phone booth, the two of us.
Now, I don't know how tall you are, but I'm probably, like, up to your shins.
Yeah,
maybe, you know.
I keep looking down. I'm normal human size, so anyways,
not quite your shins.
I guess we gotta call the other job, right?
Yes, I suppose we should call that one as well. I'll it's like you said, a day, so I don't have to charge again. And we'll call the miners now, the guy who wants the tools set up there.
Alrighty. Do you let me find some music while I'm saying this. You call in, and an image of a very large dwarf appears on your screen. He has a beard, probably, if you were to see him full body, it would probably cover his entire chest and hit the floor with its size. And he has a very large mining helmet over his head, very oversized. And he sort of looks at you beady with one eye, the other one's closed. And he says, "What do you want?"
"Yes, we're calling about the equipment you wanted delivered."
"Equipment? I want delivered. Yeah. Oh yeah, we need the equipment from Tera."
"Yeah, from Tera."
"Well, yeah, we need it done ASAP. We've got just about a week's time. If someone doesn't pick it up by then, we gotta do it ourselves. That's gonna be a pain in the arse."
"Can I make an insight check?"
"Sure."
"Something about this guy I just don't trust." And he reads.
He seems like he's just a very aloof person to you.
Okay.
Can I try an insight as well?
Sure. Yeah, this guy, it definitely sounds like he's covering something up.
Bluffing.
Yep.
"What happens in a week, friend?"
"That's when we start the mining."
"Huh.
Look, do you want the job or not?"
"We'll be right there."
Yeah, we want it. We're on our way to Tera."
"All right, I'll send you the coordinates. Better not screw this up. The last guy screwed it up. And when you get here," and he gives you coordinates to a second place on Luna, "you're going to have to protect the cargo on its way. Lots of bandits lately."
"Interesting. We'll make sure to keep that in mind."
"Yeah. And we better not see any damaged goods, by the way. Last guys, they damaged the goods, and that didn't end well. You'll have to pay all the expenses, and as you can imagine, mining equipment isn't cheap."
"Oh, I'm sure it's not. Anyway, we'll, guess we'll be seeing ya, ya beautiful bearded bastard," and I'm gonna hang up.
All right. And by the way, I didn't mention his name, but his name is Gelbin.
Gelbin. Well, now he's the beautiful bearded bastard.
Gelbin.
Triple B.
Gelbin, yeah. What was your read? Yeah. What was your read on Gelbin?
"Well, he's hiding something.
I couldn't get anything off of him. I...
Terrible poker face, that one. I don't know what, but figure it out. We'll get to the bottom of it, I'm sure."
Yeah, you would notice probably even that his uniform was very disheveled and not natural looking for a miner.
Didn't fit quite right in the shoulders.
Let's go there first. Let's keep our eyes peeled.
Well, we're going down. I believe we have to go to Tera and then to Luna.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, there's going to be coordinates on Tera to pick up the cargo, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the way I see it, it's 2 days there. Now, we have a week, he said, to deliver it. Now, so, yeah, of course, someone else could, you know, be trying to take that one as well.
That's why we should go there first.
But we know that the one on Tera exactly has had other people calling about it.
Mm-hmm.
What, the bounty?
Whereas, yeah, the bounty one, they said that there's been other people already calling about it. Whereas this one, he said, "Do you want the job or not?" Which implied to me at least, implied a level of "you have the job" kind of thing.
Yeah,
You would know that this is the kind of job that multiple people couldn't try at the same time.
So I feel like we have that one on lock, and we have a week to do it. 2 days to get to Tera, I believe. Or I guess, is that 3 or 2 days?
Technically, you're on Mara right now. It's just you started moving in the atmosphere. So all right,
so we're here. So we're kind of here. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4 days to get there then?
I would say that it's 3, because you move 1, 2...
3, okay. I just wanted to make sure of, like, moving onto the planet is a day, which I'm assuming it is.
Yeah, it would be.
Yeah.
So that'll give us 3 days to get there. We have 4 days to, you know, I say we take 2 days to figure out where this bandit is and deal with that, and then, you know, we have 2 more days to get up to Luna. It shouldn't be a long drive.
Yeah, that's good. I like that. Deal with the bandits first.
All right.
We gotta bring them to justice, right, friend?
Oh yeah. I thought it was the other way around.
Bring the justice to them.
Yep. So you guys kick into overdrive and push the engines to the max. Again, it shakes all over for a minute or so. But it finally smooths out when you see the stars turn into streaks as you just head full blast. You can hear the alchemical engines in the engine room from anywhere in the ship because they still need to be repaired, making very loud clunking and steaming sounds. You know that anyone with experience with ships at all realize that it will function properly, but not at full capacity. Still, you'll be able to do everything that you need to do with it right now.
Okay.
So, is there anything that you guys would like to do in the 3 days before you reach Tera?
Well, we need to figure out what each other's strengths and weaknesses are. We need to name this ship.
True. Ship name.
Sniper, I'm assuming you're good with that gun?
I hope so.
What's your range?
I haven't really used it too much. I think my range is 500.
500 feet?
At max.
Damn. Okay. That's cool. Any kind of trick shots you can do with it, or is there anything we should know about?
Basically, I think at this level, I think everything I do is a trick shot. I don't think I have the blasting wave yet. Nope. So I just have... my Thundermonger. So basically I empower it with thunder damage as well. Do big damage.
Nice.
5d6 damage.
Damn.
Very loud and very effective.
Yes.
Skills. I guess you're a good pilot.
Yep. Good at piloting, good at repairing. I have proficiency in the homebrewed repair tools.
Nice.
As well as alchemist supplies and smith tools, and I am able to navigate the old nav tools.
Yeah, in the future, you will be able to use navigation to get to places potentially faster if there's any sort of obstacles in the way.
A lot better courses.
Yeah. Right now, I didn't add in any... obstacles because there's only a few places you can go, but as you fly, occasionally there might be things that pop up.
I also did take prime directive, so I'm
a living
compass and gyroscope and, you know, altimeter.
Yeah, so you've got that. You always know you can detect the way back to the place you've been and all that sort of stuff. That's really cool. Yep.
Have my bearings, all those in the north.
Makes sense. GPS. All right, Gelbin. What weapons are you bringing to the table?
The silent kind.
The muted kind? Are you saying you're stealthy? Is this a joke?
Stares off into space for a moment. What? Oh, sorry. I was distracted on board.
He's like, what skills do you bring to the table? He just stands there like, I don't have anything, man.
I'm sorry.
Eyes welling up with tears.
I'm useless. Well, I've got my two babies here, and I'll pull out his two they're actually called pepper boxes, but I'm just going to call them revolvers. I got, you know, risk and reward here. You can notice on the handles of the guns, one is engraved with risk, one is engraved with reward.
Nice.
I'd like to get in and deal out some damage with these things. I'm also pretty quick on the draw and on the reloads. Got that going for me.
What's the effective range of those weapons?
Effective, 150. I can, however, shoot from 600, but it's not nearly as effective.
Good. Skills.
Well, as you've seen, I can definitely tell when someone's lying to me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also a pretty good liar myself. Gotta bluff the tables. I can also talk my way just about out of just about anything, and not very much escapes my scrutiny. Perception, persuasion, deception, and insight.
Love it.
But they were vague.
No. Yeah, I like the way you said it. Actually, it was really well said. Okay.
What about you, friend?
Well, I don't really have any range on my weaponry, but I do have, and I will show them the armor, the large-sized armor, as I summon it around me from the dimensional pocket at my side.
Just
kind of like all the metal collapsing out of nowhere around me. And I'll be standing there, kind of like the giant, probably much like the earlier paladin you saw, although nowhere near as big and impressive yet.
I thought you were big before.
You kind of hear it echoing through the armor. What I don't have in range, I make up for with other abilities. But I've been wanting to try something out, I'll say, walking away in my armor from them. I'm assuming we're probably in, like, the cargo hangar area at this point.
If you want to be.
I outfitted it with a new glove. I've been wondering if I could actually try and catch a bullet. Would you mind? I'll say, standing there, holding out my arm, daring him to shoot me.
I'll give him a big grin, and I'll pull out Risk. Seems appropriate.
Now, I know that your character would still do this anyway, but I will this ship is held together with duct tape and dreams right now.
Well, there's a reason we pulled out Risk.
And normally shooting in a ship could have catastrophic results, but you probably don't care about that.
Well, you know, I will give a moment to a fair chance to for the person who probably does care, Sniper, to say something.
I was gonna say, it's a kind of thing where I'm over here doing my thing, you know, I'm duct taping up panels and stuff like that, and I say, what are you doing? Stop!
I'll stand perfectly still. Just don't miss.
I don't miss, and I'm gonna go ahead and pull the trigger, and here comes the nat one, boys.
Don't get the nat one.
Ten.
Oh, sweet. Alright. So I can use my reaction and from my gloves of missile snaring. I can reduce some of that damage. Actually, I should roll that D10 right now, shouldn't I?
Yeah.
2 plus. So I reduced it by 2 damage. And so that means I don't catch the missile, just so like
poof. Goes ricocheting off against the walls, you hear loud ping.
It may need some work, I'll say, looking down at the hand.
You know what they say, practice makes perfect.
Pulse trigger again.
I kinda spin it, but I hear a hissing sound, right?
Yeah.
And I'm rushing over with duct tape.
You're rushing over with duct tape? Please, stop!
You know how to repair. I guess we're testing all of our skills today. I'll say, like, laughing innocently as the air slowly escapes the room.
Not that not that bad of an effect, but something's definitely been damaged.
Alright. Common sense will kind of take over. Maybe this isn't the greatest idea. Maybe we wait till we land. Test more.
Yeah, we should proof these walls. Set up a training area.
That'd be a good idea. You actually have 2 or 3 days, rather, to do it if you'd like. Well, or I guess you don't really have many supplies to, though, but you can clear out an area.
I'm going to clear out an area, but one thing I am going to look for is we're going to need to try and, if we're taking a prisoner, we're going to need to hold it in some sort of holding cell or possibly even just, you know, somewhere that we could keep them locked up.
And likely there's some sort of either supply closet or there was originally for some other purpose, like a laundry room. They could probably retrofit into a temporary brig.
So I'll work on that first.
Anything anybody else would like to do in the interim?
While we're traveling, I'm gonna be working on my project, i.e. the bad news. We're starting to work on that.
All right, I want you to make me some tinker tools checks then. Three of them, for one for each day.
Okay, so I'm guessing that's gonna be down here in extra skills. I'll just add it.
Yeah. Or if you have a skill that uses the same modifier.
What does the Tinker 2 use?
Whatever you think makes most sense for you.
Could be Int or Wisdom. I could see either one.
I could see Wisdom working.
Because, you know, he's... Alright, we'll use Wisdom. Yeah, we're proficient.
Yeah, whichever one's higher for you, you can use.
Alright, well, Wisdom is definitely higher than my Intelligence. That, you wanted 3?
Yeah.
Okay, there's 1... 2, 3. Ooh, the third one's not very good.
Alright.
That one was alright.
In that case, somewhere on your sheet, mark down 2 for your bad news.
Alright.
And over time, you'll eventually complete it.
Yep, works for me. We'll go over into my class, other things. This. All right, perfect.
Over my time, I'd like to start off by working on anything that's cosmetic so that I can actually see what's actually wrong. So basically cleaning up things so they look nicer to start with.
Yeah, there's a whole lot of rust and sort of dirty old panels that could be used polishing. And you also notice that there's actually a lot of not like literal... like food scraps, garbage, but a lot of like scrap all over the place that hasn't been cleaned up since
the universe. Extra nuts and bolts kind
of
thing.
Yeah, you could probably use some of it, but a lot of it's kind of useless.
Anything salvageable, I'll throw aside to be used, but otherwise, anything like trash, I'll pile up in a nice glad bag.
Hey, give me a, whatever you think that you could use to tidy up the place, but I guess repair might work. And whatever modifier you think makes most sense.
Now, do these repair tools, do they count towards my double proficiency with any tools I'm proficient with?
I'll say yeah. You do a decent enough job to get rid of some of the old rust and manage to, you know, pile up the scrap pieces. It still looks kind of crappy, but at least it doesn't look like a junk heap.
It's a good start.
And you've got a room cleared out that you can use as a temporary brig. You figured out how to break off the handle on the inside so it can't be opened from there.
I like break the handle off and be like, good thinking.
The nice. I'm thinking.
All right.
Then, so you said You wanted to look for the brand first, right? The red band?
Yep, we were after red band first. That's the competition one.
Right, let me look for some music real quick.
Now, anywhere in the... Well, I didn't read the contract, so never mind. I wouldn't know. I signed it. It was a good gamble. Gotta gamble with the legal system sometimes.
You could always ask my character since I read it.
I would ask, does anybody know if we... So this is a... They said that other people are going to be going for this. If they're hostile toward us and we kill them, like... Are we fine? Can we do that?
That depends. Because... It's not illegal to kill them if they're chasing you, if they're bounty hunters. But,
no matter who shot first.
Yeah, if...
Han shot first, we all know that.
Basically, what's going to come down to is if there's witnesses, what they think happened is going to be the deciding factor if you all get killed or not.
Well, it's a good thing that I have some persuasion and some deception.
Yeah, it's hilarious. I'm like, my answer to that would be... It's complicated, right? Like that's how I ended up ultimately getting charged for murder, right? I was just taking in a person, like, you know, just doing my job.
Yeah. So, the town, let me look at my notes really quick. The town that you were given the coordinates to, did I actually write down the name of the town? I think they named it Diesel City. And it's called a city because that's what it was called 1,000 years ago. That's what it was. But now it, to you, just looks like a sprawling of rust. It basically looks like a scrapyard from up above, and you can see occasionally there's something that looks like it's supposed to be a house or maybe a building. And you see, as soon as your ship comes into atmosphere of this place, and you can finally get a glimpse down, probably, what's your character's name again, Mark?
Mareal.
You probably see through your scope that everybody is scrambling to hide as your ship appears. And you make touchdown in what's probably something resembling a bit like an airstrip, but it's actually just, you know, a place that isn't completely filled with scrap. And you guys are now in the destination. What would you like to do?
It's hot here, isn't it?
It is not only hot, but it is extremely dry. It feels like pretty much all the moisture in the air is gone.
Tera, I hate this shithole.
It's a pretty bad one. People here are real cheapskates, too.
Something's got them really spooked. I'll note to the fact that they all ran back into their houses.
Well, yep. I mean, we did just show up.
And for reference, in case you guys didn't read about it, the people that actually live on Tera are usually referred to as Tera rats or Tera scum if you're in the company of ratlings. Pretty much nobody likes them because they're the poor, destitute people that were left behind that couldn't pay to get off Tera.
They're leeches on our great solar system.
Exactly. And people often will allow them passage off of Tera in exchange for slave labor. So what would you guys like to do?
Knock on some doors, maybe?
I guess we'll hop out. Nobody in red walking around to make this easy.
No, even when you were looking from above, you didn't see anybody walking around in red. It mostly looked like people in rags and with the, you know, sunken in stomachs. You could see their bones, but you did see there were a couple people that looked to be, you know, well off, that they don't look like they're dying also.
Never easy. I guess going door to door is probably a good call. Should we stick together or?
Yeah, we should stick together. You should probably do the talking, Gelbin. Just keep your eyes peeled.
Watch my back. Don't let anybody stick a. I would say knife, but they probably don't have that enough money to buy knives.
maybe
it's a rock in it.
Jake, he's a rock.
We are in a scrap. Scrap place too. Maybe if we could keep our eyes open for anything that we could potentially use for the ship.
Good idea.
I'll kind of focus on that as I'm following.
Yeah, you'll see that it looks like a whole lot of really old, destroyed skyscrapers basically around the area. And they sort of form these sort of divots where you can walk as a sort of road all around you. And occasionally you'll see that some rocks are propped up in certain ways to look like an entrance to home or something. And there's little doorways that are made in. And if you keep going in, you see that there's actually a few buildings that have been sort of shambled together out of old scraps of different buildings. They actually look almost like a real place, except that it's completely patchwork in design. So, I guess you come up to one of the doors, and what do you do?
I'd like to go to, if I'm able to figure this out from where we were, one of the people who didn't look like completely desolate at first.
Give me a perception check.
All right.
Or investigation. Whichever is better for you.
Ooh, not good.
All right. So you come up to a doorway. House. Yeah, and you knock on it. It's just a little lean-to. And you knock on the door. And you hear a very slight whimpering. But no response.
Hello, is anyone home? We really would like to talk.
A moment later, you hear a weak voice. Are you here to arrest us for something?
Of course not. We're here to deal with some troublemakers that have been plaguing your town.
Who?
Just some bandits and some smugglers, you know, the same old lot. Can I make a persuasion check?
Sure.
Lord. These little rolls.
You, it takes a minute, and then you see the little the scrap sort of be pushed to the side, and a small face appears. It's a human, which, as you know, it's rare in this universe. And they have sunken in cheeks as they look up at you, and they say,
"Look down. I'm short as fuck."
It's actually a child.
Oh, so I'd eye.
Yeah, I'd eye. And they say, I don't know of any guys like that.
With that, I'm gonna just give him a, "Are you sure?" And I'm gonna flick a copper piece, or not a copper piece, whatever they're called, a CP, up and do my up on my finger, and I'm gonna use my ability to kind of have it my animator ability to make it kind of spin on my fingertip.
Their eyes go completely wide, and that they hold out their hands greedily at you.
Well, now, you know, of course, I can only give this coin to someone who has some information about people. Perhaps people who are even who would be wearing some red.
Wearing red? You mean the captains?
Captain? I'm gonna inquire.
I know all about the captains. Let me have the money. They seem really desperate.
Give him a smile, and he'll flick the coin over to him.
They grab it and hold it to their chest, as if their life depended on it. As they look up at you, the captains they come around and they give us food every now and then, and they tell us, Suddenly their eyes go wide and they stop talking.
Now, a deal's a deal. Let's not re-engage on it.
And they tell us to not tell anyone they were here. They sort of pout as they realize that they just messed that up.
Now tell me, do they happen to have any, you said it was a hobgoblin, I believe?
Yeah, hobgoblin.
Do they happen to be in the company of a hobgoblin? And kind of, I'll describe what the picture of him looked like.
I haven't ever seen any hobgoblins.
Can I insight people... him on the not seeing hobgoblins thing?
Yeah, sure.
Eleven.
They seem genuine enough about it. They seem like they're not trying to hide anything from you now that they already spilled the beans on one thing.
Okay. Do you know where they normally which direction they go when they leave here?
Usually they go down that way and they just point off to the west, but they usually come from the other way. I think they're just walking around. I don't know. I don't know where they usually are, but I could tell you more for more money.
I'm going to insight that as well, if he actually has more information or if he's just trying to get more money. 17.
It seems like they're trying to get you to give them more money, but that there is something that they have in return.
Alright, we'll flick him another piece.
And they grab it out of the air very quickly and again hold it to their chest and they say, the bar, that's where lots of people go. I haven't seen him there, but people at the bar might know.
Bar? Sounds like a good place to look. We'll check it out. I'll give him.
I actually did write down the name of the place, but I guess it's Diesel City now. And they tell you that the name of the bar is Uranium Ale. And they point you roughly to the direction where you could find it. Again, there's not too many actual roads, so it's pretty easy to find the places they're going to.
Well. Fantastic. We'll check just there. And I'll kind of lean in and whisper to him and be like, make sure nobody else sees those coins. You don't want to be, you know, targeted for it.
They quickly nod their head and scurry back into their lean-to.
Before he does, I'm going to slip him three more coins.
You've made this kid very rich.
I know.
Even by regular standards, you gave him like
five
bucks. Anyways, so you guys are all headed to there, or are you gonna try knocking on some more doors?
Let's go to the Uranium Ale. When we're there, Gelbin, you should pose as somebody who's looking for work. Were your associates also looking for work? We'll show off our weaponry. Perhaps we can get some insider information. I have a feeling if we let them know who we're working for, they're going to start shutting out pretty quickly.
Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention, you guys did get official bounty hunter badges. So if for any reason you needed to actually tell people that you were bounty hunters, you'd have the official paperwork and badges. But you don't have to openly display them if you don't want to.
We'll tuck them away for now.
Yeah, I'll tuck mine.
Alright. Give me perception checks as you go.
So I'm a natural 20, equaling 23.
So Gelbin and Mareal, you notice sort of as you're walking that people's eyes are continually on you, sort of peeking out through slightly cracked doors. Occasionally hear a little scurry behind you. It seems mostly like the people are just interested in why you're there, or confused. Usually people aren't as nicely dressed as you are. And Mareal, you do notice though that you see somebody staring at you very intently for a moment, and then they disappear behind some scrap. And you don't see them again as you're walking.
I'm gonna stop. While these are people are walking past, and just stop for a moment, look over my shoulder, and then I'll keep walking.
Yeah, you get a feeling that somebody is tailing you.
When I catch up with Gelbin, I'm gonna say, "We're being tailed. Perhaps it's probably why they're scouts. Hopefully, they spotted us, and they're gonna hire us. Otherwise, they could be tailing us to rob us."
Yeah, I'm sure that display of money is, not very helpful.
Well, perhaps a display of force will even things out a little bit.
I like the way you think.
Let's show them what we got.
Let's not do that.
When the time comes.
Yeah, exactly. So again, we'll just head to the bar, I suppose, for now.
All right. As you arrive, you can see it pretty simply. It's in green paint on the side of the wall. It sort of looks like it dripped down and is very old and faded. It says Uranium Ale, and there's a very crude drawing of a mug and ale being poured into it. And the door is actually in pretty decent shape. It looks like maybe they found a new door and put it up. And it has, the windows are actually completely boarded over, though. And you walk in, and you are greeted by a very tense scene. Let me change the music because it's not tense. The room is almost completely black except for there's a few lights here and there. Most of them are green, flashing, flickering lights. Seems most of the people, however, seem to be acclimated to this, as there's probably 2-3 people scattered throughout, just sitting in booths, nursing, it seems, to be their own different drinks. All of them have different glasses than each other, even though you're pretty sure they're drinking the same thing. And there's one guy sitting at the bar with an eye patch and a long duster, and behind the counter is a mustachioed man. He looks very unkempt, but his outfit looks brand new. And he has a robe tied around his waist. Or not a robe, but what's the word I'm looking for? Basically, he's wearing a typical bartender gear.
An apron.
Apron. That's what I was looking for.
I'm gonna lean up. I'm gonna kind of get up on my tiptoes and whisper to these two. Watch that guy in at the bar. He could be trouble.
I begin staring at him intently.
Keep it a little less obvious. And I'm gonna stroll up to the. To the bar.
I'm going to keep my hood up over my head and my eyes down low so that nobody sees them glowing.
Again, by the way, you will note that all the people here, except for one of the people in the back, are human. The guy in the back seems to actually be some sort of palish dragonborn. And he's wearing a brown coat, sort of collar pulled up over the sides of his head, and it's very patchwork and looks very tattered.
Dragonborn.
Can I tell? Has a lot of these people like kind of stopped to like look at us as we came in, or most of them just?
Yeah, as soon as the door swung open and the sunlight flowed in, all the eyes, except for the guy at the bar, turned to you.
Okay, so all the other ones though are staring at us still, I'm guessing.
I guess there's only three guys, so the Dragonborn and one of the other guys at the booth who is another human, and he's wearing a sort of yellow, it almost looks like a raincoat and rain boots, and he has a very, very large mug, and he stares at you for a minute, and then he slowly turns and then begins to drink his drink. Very purposefully. You would probably be able to tell anyone who's proficient in insight that he seems to be in a rush to leave now.
Interesting. And that was the was it the guy at the bar or another guy at a table?
A guy at a table.
Okay. I'll whisper up to the big guy here. Or who can become the big guy. That guy may try and split, and maybe we shouldn't let him. And with that, I'm gonna kind of give a smile to the room and head toward the bar.
All right, the bartender sort of turns his gaze to you and he says, "Haven't seen you around these parts. What do you have?
What do you got?"
"Got uranium ale, and we got the special."
Can I insight to see if the special is just more uranium ale?
I think you'd have to find that out for yourself.
Okay. I'll have the special then, I'll say. How much?
You'll notice as you're saying that he turns around and sort of lowers a billboard that was behind him. He says, "How much you got?"
"Obviously not much, or we wouldn't be here now, would we?"
"What are you saying?"
"Come on, friend. It's Tera. No one comes to Tera wealthily."
You see all the eyes again, except for the guy at the bar, who you're probably standing right next to, turn to you, and this time there seems to be a bit of venom in their glare.
Now, I'm in the same boat as you guys are now.
"Well, that'll be 2-piece.
Oh, 2-piece.
It's the special."
I'm gonna think about it for a minute.
You either make your peace, or you get out.
I'll grudgingly pull out two piece and slide it to him. I really hope the special's worth it.
He sort of looks them over for a second, making sure they're not counterfeit. Then he plops it into his apron, and he reaches under, and he grabs out a large jug, and it sort of sloshes as he picks it up. It's a brown jug. You can just barely make out that there's something inside of it. It's just barely see-through. And you see, it looks like there's things floating in there. And he pulls out a large mug. Again, doesn't look like any of the other mugs that are there. And he starts tipping the jar. And you hear sloshing and gurgling as slowly sifting out through it is a brownish liquid. Then he sets it down and he passes it along to you.
I'll grab it and kind of hunker up on a bar stool, and you're like, I'll just kind of start making some conversation with them, you know, be like, so now that we're here, me and my pals here, we're gonna be needing to find something to do for work. Got any ideas? Anything you know?
Not many people hiring around here. Most people make their own way. And he gives you a very intense stare, almost as if he needs convincing.
Convincing. I'd like to attempt to persuade him to, you know, like, listen, you know, here's the thing. Your establishment seems to be one of the nicer ones around, and, you know, if you have any idea at all where
I hear the guy at the bar laugh a bit when you say it's the nicest ones around.
So if you have any at all, you know, information that could help us, you know, I would love to come here and spend even more money. But, you know, obviously if I don't have a job, I don't. And 19 for persuasion.
Alright, he's sort of wiping down one of the mugs that he has behind the bar, and he says, well, I think I got some things in mind, but it takes strong people to do these jobs. But you finish up that drink of yours.
I'll kind of I have to savor it. I'll put it up like I'm drinking it, but I won't actually like drink anything. I'll kind of tilt it back so it kind of goes.
Give me a deception check.
On my face, but not in my throat. 17.
Yeah, seems convinced well enough, and he's like, "Is it burn?"
Pretty good.
And you hear one of the people, the guy in the raincoat, say, "First time I heard that about the special." And the barkeeper kind of laughs, and he's like, well, it looks like you at least got a strong stomach or strong force of will.
Yes. Unfortunately, though, my size doesn't really constitute very much, so I'm going to kind of turn and I'll pass it back to Mareal. Here you go, friend.
I'll put my hands around the cup. We're just going to be staring now directly at this bartender. I think you need to tell us what we need to know now, I'll say, tilting my head up from the ground so he will begin to see the glow of my eyes.
You, the guy in the raincoat suddenly puts down his drink, and you hear him trying to very discreetly scuttle out.
I'm going to point at him. Not even looking at him, I'm just going to point. And I'm going to say, you might want to stay right there. Right there.
And mid-walk, he freezes.
and sort of looks over at you with his eyes. He doesn't even tilt his head to look at you, and he doesn't even say anything. Seems very afraid of you.
You stay right there. I'd be much obliged. I'm gonna keep looking at this bartender. All right.
I don't want any trouble. Listen.
I don't either, so.
I don't know. I don't know anybody that has any jobs, but I think I might know what you're looking for. There's some guys that come around every now and then. Some people here call them the captains because they come wearing capes, but the real name for them is the Red Brand. The Red Band. Occasionally, they'll recruit people, but mostly they come from other planets. They usually like to keep things quiet. Maybe they'll let you join, but I wouldn't be able to say when they're gonna appear. I'd like you all to make some insight checks. All right. Don't notice anything out of the ordinary. The mood seems to be the same as it was before. Everyone's kind of on edge. And this guy, he seems to be completely honest with you. He really doesn't want any trouble, and he's just trying to get things to go along.
I don't want any trouble either, friend. But do they have a generalistic schedule in which they're here? You said a couple of weeks. Is there a pattern at all? Maybe you have some idea on where they travel to. We don't want to waste too much
Look,
time.
I don't got a calendar. Don't got a watch. All I know is sometimes they're here, sometimes they're not.
I'm turning around and facing the Dragonborn.
He has a long, like, sort of a fluke glass in front of him, and it seems to be filled with a greenish glowing liquid. And he sort of looks back at you and sort of lifts a brow like, why are you looking at me?
Seem to be leaving there in a little bit of a hurry. I'm going to stay walking towards him.
It was the guy in the coat that was running.
Oh, I'm sorry. I meant the guy in the coat. I'm turning
to
him.
Yeah, he sort of shakes as you stare at him. And he stays completely still. He says, look, I don't want any trouble, man. I just wanted to drink and get drunk. Got to forget about some things.
Was that also the guy who was looked like he was trying to hurry out of here earlier?
Yeah, it's the same guy. He was also okay. The one who... we talked about the special. Nobody called the special.
But he's not. Default. He was not the guy who was at the bar, though.
Nope. The guy at the bar is the one with the eye patch.
What are you trying to forget?
Do I really have to go into my personal life?
I'll just kind of give him the get out of here.
And he very gladly obliges and just bolts.
Save us a lot of time. I'm going to say really loud now, speaking to the rest of the people in the bar. If anybody who knew anything about this group were to step forward with some information.
Give me an intimidate check.
I was hoping for it.
Oh, yeah. You see... The bartender seems like he honestly doesn't seem like he has anything else, but he's getting ready to, like, quell the conversation, and then all of a sudden the guy at the bar who has stayed mostly silent sort of stands up, turns around. You see his eye patch sort of covers it looks like a bunch of scar tissue that just around it. And he looks at you with one beady eyeball that looks partially milky white, like he's also going blind in that one. And he says, "I know him. I can tell you when they're coming."
Why don't you say so sooner? That's so much more convenient.
Gotta be something in for me, though.
How about not death? How about not being charged with aiding and abetting criminals?
Yeah, sort of sighs. He's like, "Damn, I was hoping I'd at least get something out of that. You guys are tough. All right. I'll tell you when I'm expecting them to come around. See, they sometimes do some dealings, legal dealings with me. I work in construction, or what you can call construction. I'm not sure what you fancy otherworlders would call it. But next 2 days, probably to tomorrow night, they'll be coming."
Can I incite him?
Yeah.
Natural 20?
Yeah, he seems like, even though he has a cool exterior, he's kind of really scared of the current situation, so he's just spilling the beans.
I'll be gripping both of my short swords. "Now you're sure, Gelbin? Nothing illegal?"
What?
"They weren't doing anything illegal. He wasn't up to anything illegal."
Oh, yeah. What? So it was he lying about anything illegal?
No. He wasn't lying.
Nah. This guy seems like he's by the books.
I'll like slowly nod my head at him. My hands are still at the blades, though.
And he sort of raises one hand. He's like, "Look, I'm not armed. Ain't no reason to be showing no weapons." And you probably, Gelbin, you noticed that he's lying about not being armed.
All right. It's good to know.
Probably, by the way, that as he's raising his hand, he seems to put his other hand in a peculiar way against his pocket, like he's touching his weapon.
Well, I will
not in his pocket, but on his pocket.
Yeah. Well, I will. I have an ability called Quick Draw. I'm gonna pull out one of my guns and be like, "Now. Let's not do any of that kind of stuff."
Yeah, sort of jumps back and puts up his other hand. Jesus, a real piece.
I kind of surprised that you moved that quickly too. Kind of jump back and it's like, "Holy crap."
Or not Jesus. I'll come up with something that he would say.
Nova?
Nova.
Raptor,
yeah.
Jesus.
Nova, that's your... Yeah, Nova's good.
Nova above.
Like it.
That's awesome. I'm writing that down so I remember that.
All right.
Sniper, why don't you...
I'll move over to disarm.
Yeah, he doesn't attempt to stop you, and all of the others are staring at you very intently, like they are kind of seeing what you're up to at this point.
You have proper registration for this firearm?
Ain't no registration on Tera.
I'm gonna look up at him. He's right.
Right.
But it's a simple enough. It looks more like just a old slug thrower. Maybe it'll it doesn't even look like it's actually held together well enough to shoot more than one or two. It looks like in this case kind of like a Renaissance pistol. It's one they have to load with a rod and all of that
black powder ramming rod.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, Sniper, you can go ahead and put it on the bar there. We're not gonna take his means of defense, and I don't blame you for reaching for it. Smart instinct.
So you said tomorrow? Where?
Here.
What time?
Well, that's good.
Night. We don't got watches.
Why don't you set up a meeting with them?
I mean, I don't talk to them except when they're here. I mean, if you want me to... Yeah, just there's someplace you want me to tell them to go, or...
Yeah, tell them you've got something to show them. We'll need an area near here.
Look, man, if they think things are suspicious, they're probably gonna kill me.
If I don't get my man, I am going to kill you.
And, sort of feel the tension rise in the room as, your intentions are very plainly put out now. And, the man's like, all right, I see what you mean. Look, I'll set it up. I'll bring him where you need him to.
Well, that would be most gracious of you, friend. And, you know, to make sure you, don't say anything here, I'm gonna give him two copper pieces. There may be more, or CP. I don't know what I want to call. Peace. I'm gonna hand him two piece, and you know, give him there might be more in that when you know, all said and done. And now listen, you know, you can, if you need anything, you can deal with me, but if you lie to me, or I feel like you're gonna, you know, turn on us, well, then you have to deal with my friend over there. And we've seen how well that's been going for you.
Yeah, sort of sighs. He's like, yeah, I'll get you. Look, just tell me where you need him, and I'll bring him there. Or I'll try to. I can't really make any promise.
You remember that, landing strip like area you talked about?
Yeah.
Somewhere in around there should do.
Okay. All right. Tomorrow night, I'll bring him.
You, sir, and we will see you there. Again, remember, the repercussions for going against us will be either pretty or pleasant for you.
Remember to tell them that you have a shipment for them. They might be interested in.
They gives a nod, and he doesn't talk because my voice hurts. And and he agrees, and you guys part in your merry way. So what are you going to do until tomorrow night?
All right, guys. Well, I think the plan is we set up the sniper ambush thing, right? So... Sniper, you can be 500 feet away, have your, do the classic meet, you know what I mean? But you're going to be with your guns trained on the opposition. We'll be inside the cargo. By we, I mean that's Gelbin and me. Hopefully Gelbin's going to be able to get the quick draw to get the drop on them if anything goes down. And I'll be there if shit does really hit the fan. And yeah, hopefully they bring their leader with them. If not, we've got to make sure at least one of them's alive by the end of the shooting, so that we can torture them until they give us their secrets.
Do we have a form of comm system?
Not currently, no.
All right.
Intership, yes, but not outside of the ship.
Okay.
Listen, if you see me draw and shoot, that means shoot.
Yeah.
My guns are pretty loud, you'll know.
Not to mention your gut's gonna have a good feeling of when the shit's actually gonna go down. I'm glad I'll be close to you.
Sounds like a plan to me.
Now, tell me if when I put you on this that things look very spoilery to you.
Aw, so many spoilers.
spoiler. Oh my god. Is that the Justice League movie? I'm just kidding.
I wouldn't say very spoilery. There is, in fact, something up here dead. That's a spoiler.
No, that's don't there. Worry. There's just a dead guy laying in the alleyway.
Okay, that's fine.
This shit's normal on Tera.
Yeah, it is pretty normal.
I'm surprised that, you know, there's some nice looking buildings here. I'm surprised. It's a nice street for Tera. It's a nice street.
They got barrels.
Barrels. Boxes. Trash cans.
Oh, there's a ship. Perfect. Yeah, I love it, because that's pretty much what we do is we want to set up Sniper in a Sniper spot. Us kind of in the cargo. Him kind of waiting out back, or out front or whatever, so... yeah.
This guy probably doesn't have a ship, so we need to, like, have some kind of box that we're in.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's why I said the cargo, and we can use, yeah, barrels.
We can have the deal. I think we should have the deal, like, over here.
Yep.
And we can just have Sniper on our ship, laying prone on the ship.
Oh, if Sniper's on the ship, yeah, then he can get to it and fire it up real quickly, too.
Exactly. If we need to go, he can hop in and...
Nice.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty much the plan. I mean, it's... straightforward ambush, the straightforward, you know, set up the meat, and then somebody else there with the sniper rifle thing, but,
So basically, is it, our friend, Gelbin is outside of the crate, though, and he's going to be...
Gelbin will be in the crate?
No, we're both in the crate.
And I'm in the crate.
This will probably help you guys if I put your tokens down.
Yeah, be in the crate. I won't have, my armor out yet.
Yeah, let me...
So I'll be ready here. I'll be ready to, like, into a large size, but we can both fit in that crate, and then
let me ask this from on top of the ship. Can you see like over this kind of stuff here?
Yeah, I'll see.
Okay.
We're prone. Scope out. Yeah. Calibrated.
This is awesome.
I'm small. I'm gonna ride on your robotic shoulders.
Since you guys can position yourselves.
Probably like here.
Yep, that's what exactly what I was thinking. Just enough. Well, we have a lot of range to work with, so we can go further away if you want.
True. Yeah, I mean we could go like.
So as well clear the distance like, as much as possible. Here, so yeah, that's the longest like, possible vantage. But still, we're talking hundreds of feet, right?
Yeah. We could go even like up here in the alleyway. They could come from like
whichever
way they want
to. What's great too is I believe even your pistol ranges are 150 feet. So both of yep. your guns are fully in range
fully
at this point, covering both
see,
side
like,
to side. Yeah, we'll have, and don't worry if anybody, I can move quickly if I need to. I can get the jump on our bad guys and smash them really hard. I think this is a plan. Hope they bring the leader. If they don't, like I said, make sure one of them's still alive.
I will say for the sake of real estate, and because if you guys are standing there, actually, these walkways go for a very long while. They'd be able to see you well before you reach them.
Well, that's what we're going to be inside of a box type
thing. Oh, okay.
We're so inside of the crate.
You want me to grab this?
Yeah, we're basically want to make it look like we are the cargo. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. We're inside of the thing, and then we have the guy... making the meeting like here waiting for them to show up and then
yep
bada bing we pop out and like here we listen for a while we see what's going on at the leaders here we pop out hey nobody move
that's why I was careful to tell him to make sure to tell them that he was they were bringing cargo
bringing cargo and they're gonna be interested in it I believe.
Yep, such a classic setup but I love it.
All right, so let me see here, gotta change layer. Is there anything else besides the planning that you want to do in the day that you have?
Yeah, there should be other stuff we could probably do now that we set up that.
Can I scrape off some of the exterior rust and polish it up?
Sure, you could try that.
I'm going to look to see if we could purchase some scrap. I don't know how much money we have left, but maybe we could purchase a few bits of scrap metal just to use to patch up.
You're going to have to give me a intimidate or persuasion check to be able to not get completely screwed over on the price.
Okay, let's see what happens. Intimidation? Maybe I'll bring my buddy for the persuasion. 17 on the intimidation.
Yeah, you can, for a total of 12 piece, you can acquire a
decent amount of scrap of different sizes and proportions. It's not good quality, but it will hold up enough that you could make something with it temporarily.
Okay. I will spend a 12 piece, and I'll bring that. Make sure to bring that back to Sniper so that he can put good use to it.
Anyone else have anything they want to do?
I guess since they're doing that, I'm just going to be still working on my masterpiece.
Oh, yeah.
Give me another check.
Masterpiece. 25.
All right, give yourself another point toward it.
3.
How did my buff job go with the 12?
Again, it looks okay. It doesn't look serviceable, but it looks like not shit.
It's getting rid of a good amount of the rust.
Like, it doesn't look new by any stretch.
We're almost to the point we can paint it.
Exactly. Like, you got rid of it enough that you could probably start painting it soon.
Good, good.
And the entire area around the ship is just covered in rust flakes.
I like this for something, I'm sure.
And you see that a lot of eyes are on your ship as it sits there. Occasionally you'll see somebody's head poke up, sort of watch you guys.
I am constantly with my sniper rifle, although it's like on my back, so I mean, I'm...
Yeah, they are definitely keeping their distance, though. No one's like getting right up next to the ship or looking like they're gonna run in and swipe anything. But anyways,
big old robot cleaning up the ship.
So I think that's about it. Then we're gonna hunker down, I guess, and wait for the deal to go south. That's how these deals always go.
Fix these real quick, and then, I guess I can try to talk while I'm doing it. So as you guys are sitting around on the time specified, which isn't very specific, you begin to hear some footsteps coming from over in this direction, and you hear that voice of the eye-patched man.
Yeah, the cargo is up ahead. It's a really big shipment.
And you don't hear anybody responding to him, but you hear a number of other footsteps coming.
Before we start this, okay, if I run out for a quick break?
Oh, yeah, we could take a break, sorry.
Hey, I'm going to go to the washroom. I'm just going to put on a tee, so.
Yep, we can take a quick break.
Thank you very much,
sir. I'll be right back then.
I'm going to make this ship shine, Alex. I'm going to make this ship shine.
Going to learn today.
I hope you have an updated ship picture for once we've have it shining and ready to go.
I am back.
Make him big.
I'm back, y'all.
Just in time for the song, then.
What do you know?
Is everyone else here?
It's like it was planned.
It's like, no, not yet. I'm gonna wait till the song's done.
Put his heads on.
No, we wait.
All right. Let's hunt some bounties.
So you guys have positioned yourselves properly. Feel adequately hidden. And you can hear some footsteps coming from that direction. You hear...
Yeah, that's another... It's a big shipment for you. I just got it in.
And again, you don't hear any voices speaking in response. They seem to be stonewalling him. And you hear him stop around like right here. I don't have a token for the dude. But you hear him stop around right there, and he's like, all right, so this is my shipment that I got in. Just as he says that, you hear a gunshot and a thud.
Well, that's first-degree murder if I ever did see that.
There's no way that he actually had a shipment.
And probably through the cracks you can see a man in a sort of a bulky black clothing with a red scarf wrapped around his head and neck.
This is some kind of trick.
And,
I am charging out of the cargo and activating the armor.
Alright. Let me get... Oh, crap.
Whoa! You've power charged, alright? You are so hard, he moved the earth.
I gotta flop some other dudes down the map.
Rotated the whole planet. He's Chuck Norris, actually, if you didn't know.
Level of rage is unbound.
Alright, that's what you're working with. So everyone give me some initiative in that case. Let me hit this button. You might need to shorten your name on your sheet just so.
Sniper.
And also I should change the name of these guys because they're not called Black Earth currently.
How big does it make his thing?
Do you not see it over there?
No, I don't see your name. I think only you and him can see it. You're just trying to see your token.
My name is five lines long.
God damn it. Oh boy, I knew your name was going to be a real treat.
Alright. Well. I'm going to say Gelbin technically goes first.
Mm-hmm.
But the sniper, but you two give me a stealth check. Let's see if maybe you get surprise on them.
Oh yeah, good point. Stealth's not exactly my good strong suit.
11. Not great.
10.
Pretty average.
They notice you beforehand, so it's not a surprise round, but. I'm still
quick on the draw.
I'm still gonna, since you're the initiator, I'm still gonna let you
use the bonus action.
Yeah. Use the bonus action.
Thanks, man.
To summon it.
Sweet. That means I'll be turning into my armor form, transformation sequence.
Yeah.
Hey, Chuck.
Yeah. Basically. It will start with my arm, and then, like, all around me, the bits of metal will just clank on until I form this larger shape armored thing. Now, with the two blades no longer in my sheathed in my side, but shooting out of the front of my hands.
All right, and Gelbin, you are up first.
Yep, FYI, you got to re-add Mark to the initiative. Because his token wasn't.
Shit. Okay. That's sorry.
Okay. I can do it again. I'll just... But it's no worries. I go last anyway, so a little bit sorted out by them.
So, in response to their statement of it's some kind of trick, I'll say not a trick, just a calculated risk, and I'll step out and I'll take a shot at this guy first.
All right. You will notice, by the way, that all of them are carrying guns.
Ooh. All right, so we're gonna give him a shot. 20 to hit.
That is hit for 6 damage.
Yep, 6 damage. We're going to give him another. We're going to shoot him again, second attack. 19 to hit.
That is another hit.
And that's 12 damage.
Yep. He's still up.
All right. Then we're going to use the bonus action attack from Crossbow Master for a third shot. Going back to risk again. 27 to hit.
You notice that you give 3 devastating shots into this guy, but he seems, as you sort of blow through his clothing, you notice that there's some very compact armor underneath. These guys definitely are more well-dressed than most people on Tera, so again, you probably realize they don't mostly work in Tera. They're only here for to cover up their tracks.
Okay.
And he's standing up, but you notice he's a little wobbly on his legs.
Okay. Then we're just gonna kind of slide kind of behind these barrels, see if they can kind of give me any cover or not. Probably not much, but
yeah, for some of them it would definitely give you cover, especially because they're small.
Yeah, I'm also trying to hide behind my big armored buddy.
Yeah, that too, that would also help.
And that'll be my turn.
All right, so it's their turn now. This one who you injured is going to take a disengage and start running toward the alleyway. And he's gonna try to look around to see if there's anyone else. So give me a stealth check there, Sniper. And his panic, he doesn't seem to notice you. And let's see. This guy in front, he decides to pull out a long sword instead of his gun. Sorry, 1 second. Twenty-4 to hit. And he sort of slashes across your armor and deals 6 piercing damage.
Ooh, 6 piercing damage? Okay.
Yeah. And this other guy's gonna come running around. Actually, this one is going to try to run, but he's not gonna disengage first, so you can make an opportunity attack if you want.
I shall. Oh, yes. Sorry.
It's all good.
There. Nice.
All right. Well, oh, you forgot to add in the crit damage, so just roll 2d6.
Yeah, okay.
voice.
So it's so
yeah.
16 damage, 16 piercing damage.
Yeah, you slash at his back and he gives a heavy groan. You see a blood sort of spray across, but he keeps running. And he actually gets behind this and pulls out his firearm. And from where he's standing, he can't really shoot anyone else, so he's going to aim for Gelbin.
Hold on one second. I'm going to see if I have to use it now. No, it's as a bonus action. Never mind. We're good.
All right. And he takes a shot. You notice that these, they're definitely not as good as either of your guns, but they're functional enough.
Okay.
17 to hit?
Yep, that'll hit.
For 11 piercing damage.
All right.
As a bullet just ricochets, I mean, not ricochets, goes flying through the air. And there's sort of a loud popping crack. And let's see. This other guy, he doesn't actually pull out a weapon. You see his hands sort of morph a bit, and like as you hear a soft crack as his fingers turns into claws, and he comes slashing at you, Ariel. One of them misses, and the other one is 24 for 8 slashing damage.
Okay.
And actually, I just remembered this other guy actually got 2 shots, so I'm actually going to roll another one for him. Sorry. Wow. Another 24. So Gelbin, you take another 10 piercing damage as he lets out a second shot, and you see him frantically beginning to reload his firearm. And that is the end of their turn. So, Sniper, it is now your turn. These two guys look injured. This one especially.
Are they both kind of like hunkering down here to still fight, though?
Yeah, this one behind the barrel especially looks like he's ready to fight.
I'm going to try and pop him in the back of the head.
All right. And you're going to have advantage because he didn't see you.
Yep. Well, I'm laying prone, so I have advantage anyway.
Yeah, that's true.
Because I took the stand.
Three to hit. Yep. So describe how you kill this man.
Basically, there's a slight charge up to my weapon, a loud crack in the night, and then his head just explodes. Probably goring the back of his friend a little bit.
Yeah, you see the other guy spin his head around and like look incredulously as his friend's head is just gone. And he topples the ground. I'll leave it there just for our sake. Is there anything else?
Nope. I believe that is everything.
You could reload as bonus.
Yep, that's basically just a reload.
All right, Mariel.
Okay, so I am going to I'm going to use my bonus action. I'm going to activate an ability on my armor. It's called Shields Up. And using it, I will throw a shield up around my friend Gelbin there. So basically a disadvantage to attack rolls to hit him until he takes damage.
All right. You put a little shield icon on him.
Yeah. And he's got shields now protecting from me. And then I will turn to these two. Now, if I make my attack action, I get an extra attack. that mean I can make two offhand attacks as well?
An offhand attack is a bonus action.
That's right. So I can only just make the two attacks. Okay, yeah. With my normal.
You can
okay.
use either hand, but yeah, you could.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's cool. It's good. It's good with me. So that's an 8 on the first attack.
Unfortunately, that is a miss.
And an 11 on the second attack.
Are you...
Is it missing my proficiency?
What's your strength modifier? Yeah, that might be.
I think it's missing my proficiency.
Yeah, it's not. You're not proficient with it. Probably because it's a special weapon or something. It's not like.
No, I got my proficiency checked.
Let me look at your sheet real quick.
20 plus the 5 for your strength, I'm guessing. And then.
Oh, it says he got 14 strength?
Yeah.
So it's adding it then, because proficiency is 3, right? It's adding it all at once, though. It's 3 plus 5.
Yeah, so
3
there.
Plus 2.
So that was right. Then plus 5?
Yep.
What did you take for your ability sure. stat increased levels?
They went to... I think they went to strength, actually. I don't know.
He could have also taken a feat. I was just wondering, because he had 14 strength. I wasn't sure.
Yeah, the 14 and a 16. And then I have 2 ability bonuses I put in there as well. So probably constitution. I'm not sure where they ended up, but they ended up somewhere.
Because you should at least have 14 strength to start.
Yeah, but 14 to 16, and then, I don't know if you saw what my rolls were, they weren't that good. I might have upped my con and my int, maybe, to get the plus ones, squeeze the plus ones out of them. I know I got an extra, I liked the intelligence bonus there because it gave me an extra thing. Anyways, I know I spent them, I don't know where I spent them, to
okay.
be honest with you. I just right. mitigated my very mediocre, very bad attribute rolls. But, you know, that's part of what makes character cool. anyways.
Yeah, I forgot to mention.
Plus 5, is that right?
Ask, I guess.
Yeah. So.
Forgot to ask, I guess. Did you guys want to all do the roll, or are you okay with him doing the roll? Do you want to also do it? I mean, we'd have to, you know, retcon it after this fight. I forgot to ask it at the start, though.
I'm sorry, what are you asking?
If everyone else wanted to do the roll, or if they're okay with him having done it, or if they just wanted to take the standard.
I did the point by thing, so you had said 27 points or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. That's why I'm point by.
Okay.
Doesn't matter to me though.
Oh yeah, but also, don't you get a bonus from your race to your strength and charisma?
Paul and Azimir get the strength.
Yeah, I should have plus 2 more charisma. You start with a 14 and a 16. Yeah, my charisma should be 18.
But either way, those would
and my strength should be 15.
Still be the same, though.
Yeah, that's the reason the attributes don't coy add up. But yeah, you're right, I should have 18 charisma.
Happens.
Yeah, they don't mad up either on the point by the 27. It was rough. It hurt.
Gelbin.
All right. We're gonna start off. We're gonna take another shot at this guy here. You said he looked kind of hurt, right?
Yeah, he is sort of hobbling.
All right, we're just gonna take a shot at him then. We're gonna give him a reward for his efforts. Natural 20.
Jeez.
15. That is a death shot. Tell me how you kill this guy.
Basically, as he's you know, he turns around to see his friend's head explode. You know, then he's gonna, then you know, his head will also explode.
Makes sense.
Actually, his head won't explode. There'll be a hole through his head. I don't think my guns are the same caliber of head explosion.
He, sort of
red gush appears behind him in your scope, sniper, as he also topples the ground dead.
All right. Second attack is going to go at this guy here, and we're going to use a grit point to add one damage die and up the misfire chance by one.
Okay. So what is it misfire on now?
It is on 3, I believe.
Okay.
It's 3. Go ahead and this shot, and we're going to use risk this time. 17.
You notice that the bullet strikes against his armor, and you hear a solid thunk as it sort of just topples, sort of rolls off and falls onto the ground. CB okay. Wearing some pretty good armor.
Alright, so this guy's got good armor. We'll then just use the bonus action to just try and shoot him again. No grit this time. 19.
That is a hit.
Alright, so 8 piercing damage to him. And then I'm going to very short and stubby. We'll just stay where
this goes on for quite a way, but it doesn't really go anywhere for like.
If there's not like anything like to duck behind within the next like 5 feet, then like it's used. I mean, I can only move 25 feet, so. There's like a box, like, you know, 5 more feet this like right here. Cool. If not, you know, just
yeah, there's not really anything else over that direction.
Fair enough. So he's just gonna stay here and like hope these guys
if you move a little bit further away.
I guess I'll move kinda this way.
Yeah.
I'll move down the street.
Step back.
So cause he has a valid point. I see what he's trying. So I'll move this way after. Basically, I'll take off running and shoot a couple bullets at this guy while I'm going.
Okay.
And that will be my turn.
Alrighty. Their turn again. The guy with the claws sort of turns toward you, Gelbin, and he leaps ferociously toward you. So again, Mareal, you can make an attack of opportunity.
Let's hope I roll decent.
Just a glance against his armor. Feels very solid. It seems to be somewhat high tech because it's also very compact. But you see as his robes get torn away you can see some sort of black plating. And that he comes rushing at Gelbin and he swings with his claws.
Disadvantage because of my shields.
Yep. Let me see here. What am I looking for? There we go. Yep. Okay, I need to reroll 12 to hit, so that's a miss. And then a second one. Nope, 222s.
Well, there we go.
That'll hit.
But the first one did make him miss, the first attack. Yep. But the second one swings through and it smashes through the shield and deals 7 slashing damage.
So that means my shields are down.
Shields down, Captain.
And the one here, he sort of looks at the situation and he's gonna disengage and start trying to run away. So he's like 10 more feet further than this. Sniper. Oh, also this guy just realizes what mistake he made because he sees the dead bodies.
Sniper, do you have the shot?
So this guy who's running, do I have any vision of him?
Because of the rooftops and the way that it's working, not really.
Okay, so it's not like I have just, you know, partial cover on him or anything like that?
No, you probably can't see him at all.
Sniper, okay, do you have the shot?
So I'm gonna take a shot on this guy then.
Maybe. 21 to hit.
That is hit.
For 24.
And the bullet sort of like rips through his shoulder and he goes flying back a bit. And see him just cough up blood and it sort of stains and sort of meshes in with his red scarf. But you notice now that his shoulder's sort of exposed that his arm doesn't look normal. It looks like it's sort of stitched onto his body. That being your turn?
I'm just gonna reload and end my turn.
Alright, Mareal.
So, he's not that far away from me, right? I can still get out
to him? No, he's still within range for you to chase him.
I'm still kind of on the... Still, like, I guess Sniper doesn't have the shot. And I'm going to charge forward, and my bonus action, when using my last piece of gold dust, is going to be to empower... It's a bonus action, so I can move to him, and I'm also going to make a grapple check.
All right, so I have advantage.
I have advantage, yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Just learn from Zandan. Grapple.
Yep. I learned a lot.
You got a 9. So
that is an athletics check, right, with advantage?
Yeah.
Okay, so here we go.
Yep.
Acrobatics.
That was acrobatics.
Dummy.
But you rolled an 11, which is better than 9.
So, yeah. That's much better.
It's fair enough.
So you very easily grab onto him, and he seems to immediately stop moving, petrified, as like your armor sort of bulges out and sort of strengthens itself.
I just, like, stare at him, breathing on the other side of the mask. You're gonna talk, right?
He doesn't give a response quite yet.
I'm going to...
That uses up one of your attacks to do something else.
Oh, it was one of my... Well, that was my attack. Yep. Yeah.
Yep, you can use a grapple to replace an attack on your turn.
Oh, so I still have another attack?
And
some movement too.
Bonus
right?
attack too, yep.
So I can move.
It would have taken 30 to move up to him.
Yeah, okay, good.
But you would still have.
My
bonus
action
bonus
was the empower.
Yeah.
So I have one more attack. It says you can use my action to use this, so I can't use that. So what I'm going, what I'm going to do, is I'm going to just place my hands around his head now, and I am going to intimidatingly say, "You need to tell me, or I'm going to squish your head," and that will be the end of my turn.
Fucked up, man.
On his turn, I'll have you roll the intimidate, and we'll see what happens.
Sounds good to me,
Gelbin.
All right, so this guy's like kind of on like he said he kind of got pushed back to a knee. He's like laying, he's here, and he's like got a big hole in his shoulder, right?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm just gonna like stroll up beside him, put my gun to his head, and pull the trigger.
All right. Hey. Oh yeah, you have a crossbox, which you see. Don't have this advantage. Yep.
I'm assuming a 12 will miss.
Yeah.
I'm going to make another attack, and I'm going to spend a grit point to give myself advantage on it.
Nice. Do it.
21.
Yeah.
15 piercing damage.
Tell me how you splat this guy.
I said, basically, I just stroll up, put the gun to his temple, and just... And he just kind of slumps over on his side. And since I killed somebody, that means I get one grit point back, putting me back to 2.
Indeed.
Oh wait, I also crit, didn't I, at one attack?
Yeah,
that crit became before the grit, though. so it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So I'm still at 3. Or I'm still at 2. And then I'll just kind of stroll up right around here. Keeping a little bit back. And I'll be like, oh, he's going to talk. Or I'll end up just like his friends did. I'm going to smile. And that'll be my turn.
All right, give me that intimidate with advantage.
Intimidate with advantage. I didn't realize I must have closed my character sheet. So here we go. Intimidate with advantage.
He sort of stops moving for a second, and it seems for a moment that he's going to reach for his gun at his side, and then he stops. What do you need to know?
I want you to take us to your leader.
I'll take you to our hideout. Just don't kill me.
Okay. I want you to tell me everything about the hideout. Its defenses, its layout. And I'm going to still be holding him by the head.
Yeah. You feel him trembling, even through your armor. It's like, I don't know too much, honestly, but I'll tell you what I do know. They keep one guy on watch on the roof. There's guys in the first room. There's another, the boss, he likes to be in the back room of the warehouse with the goods. It's like 5 of us back there. And then the boss, and that's about what I know. I'll show you how to get there.
There's a guy on a roof. What's he using the scope with?
I don't know.
Is there any good hiding place roughly 500 feet away from that?
I haven't really thought about it too much.
You better start thinking.
He's like, there's a toppled building. Maybe we get up there on the rubble and maybe check it out.
Maybe I crush your head.
I can't say for sure. I haven't been there.
Okay. I'm gonna look over towards Gelbin. So like you'll physically see the huge helmet head that I'm wearing, like, and my, as if there is still a body underneath, kind of like moving and motioning towards you, Gelbin.
I will insight him for the big scary robot guy.
Okay, I'll give you advantage too.
Because it's kind of big and scary. 23.
He is very scared and telling the truth.
Is there any back exit out of the back room where the boss is?
There's a sewer.
A sewer.
That's about all I could think of.
Where does the manhole come in and out?
There's two places. There's one in the first room, and there's one in the back room. The entrance is like 100 yards from there. There's some nasty stuff down there, though. I don't know if you want to go through it.
I'm going to walk him over, carrying him by the head still, and like holding him out like a piece of trash in front of Gelbin. Is that everything?
You're not going to kill me, are you?
No, I'm placing you under arrest.
That's worse!
Yes.
That's the point, scumbag.
That's justice. I'm gonna say. I'm gonna take out the handcuffs, put the manacles on him.
He's just a defeated man. He doesn't even resist.
Take him to the brig.
You do notice, though, since you're manacling him, that his arms also seem a little strange. They seem thinner and longer than they should be.
No, those claws.
For a human, that is.
Interesting.
So, since I'm guessing I kind of saw what this guy was going on, right?
Yeah.
Can I, like, pull down his shirt kind of thing, or is it, like, kind of hard to get at, or is it something I could, like, easily pull and kind of show his shoulder?
I mean, he's got some armor in the way, but he's not really resisting you guys, so you could do it eventually. And you see that he has the arms are actually slightly grayish in color compared to his skin tone, and they're stitched onto his shoulder.
So what's going on with these arms here, friend?
He sort of looks away embarrassedly. We're arms dealers.
Please. I look at my revolver and I think I should kill this man. But I don't.
We... Because you're going to kill me if I don't tell you anyway. I might as well.
Listen, it's me or the big guy, and you want me. That's all it needs to be said about that.
We smuggle, but we specialize mostly in exotic creatures and body parts. And these are one of our specialties. We graft on limbs for combat reasons.
Didn't do you very much good this time, did it?
No, they don't do very good against bullets.
Most things don't.
No arms are above the law.
I didn't want to have to make that horrible joke, but...
Gilvin's going to rub his eyes. Oh, God. It's painful.
It's Jeez. What the boss says.
You're just lucky we're not the pun police.
I am. Please just throw me wherever you're gonna throw me.
Oh yeah, we're taking him back to his brig.
Yeah, we could say that you toss him in and lock him proper.
Yep.
I'm gonna take this opportunity to use my healing surge, or it's not called healing surge.
Second wind.
Yeah. So I'm gonna roll up my second wind. I'm gonna heal some HP back up.
I can.
Yeah, you guys feel free to take a short rest.
Yeah, I was planning
on taking
a short rest.
Yeah, I should short rest and get out of my armor, actually. That's a great idea.
That way I get some HP back that I get back for the short rest.
I get my gold dust back, and I can be out of the armor. And, hey guys, we got some nifty uniforms to wear. When we go crash the party.
Some bloody uniforms.
Yeah, we'll put those red things on.
Yeah, they're just red, right?
I'm thinking, okay, if Sniper takes out the guy on the roof, right, that lets us clear in, we can get in towards the back, and Sniper can always kind of...
clear the flank if anyone tries to sneak in.
Well, I was thinking, yeah, exactly, like kind of clear, make sure nobody can get to us. We get to the back. The idea is he's probably going to escape via the sewers, right?
Probably.
That's what it sounded like.
So what if we waited for him? What if we had it set up so that we knew he was going to go into the sewers, and that's where we set up the trap? It would require a sniper taking out the roof guy, us going in, fighting our way to the back. He's gonna go down into the sewers and presumably go to the front. Am I right, Alex?
He could either leave through the front room, or he could go back to the sewers to where that entrance was. There's two escape routes, but they both go through this sewer.
Yeah. So basically, no matter what, he can escape through the sewer.
Unless someone was posted at either side, yeah.
Exactly.
We don't have the manpower to be to force them out or do that. I mean, theoretically, we could send, you know, one of us in, but if there's a gang in there and they just rush you, then you can rush whoever's in there, it'll be a mess.
If me and you fight our way to the back, he jumps down into the sewers. Sniper's taking out the roof guy. He can be at the front there, but yeah. We're just gonna need to go in guns a-blazing.
Maybe we find this sewer and we collapse it before we ever do anything.
He could block the entrance.
Yeah.
Block his out in the sewer. Like, we'd have to find where the sewer goes, not like, he can, you know, like where it comes out at, basically, where he would try and come out and get rid of that. Then we could just, you know, then he's trapped like a rat in the sewer. And we work on our time.
Yeah. We just walk our way down towards him. It's brilliant. It's brilliant. That's what we do. We have this little fuck we have in the brig over here.
Right.
Show us.
By the way,
where
do you guys want to keep?
Awesome.
Do you guys want to keep going for tonight, or would you like to call it here?
Well, it's 4 a.m, so it is getting a little past my bedtime, so to speak.
Yeah, I think before we go after this guy, I think that's a good place to.
But that being said, I do want to keep going. I just,
yeah,
I'm cautioning myself.
But I do, in fact, work tomorrow, so.
Yeah.
Man, this is so much fun. This is awesome, dude.
It is actually pretty fun. I'm enjoying this quite immensely.
I'm glad you guys are enjoying.
Is the power armor just flavored abilities, or is it something different?
I have a completely new paladin archetype here. That is, I'm guessing this is pretty much part of your world, right, Alex? Like, unique to this system anyways.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
It's called the Golden Child. So I gave up a lot of paladin abilities, but in exchange I get this cool armor.
That armor's sick.
Which is pretty cool.
It's cool. I think I was talking about how cool a blue glitter boy would be, and this is just awesome. Like, this is exactly like, this is even better than I've imagined it, so I think this Golden Child concept is going to be so fun to play. I can't wait to keep going with it.
Does it, is there, like, any adverse effects to you, like, being in it for extended periods of time?
Well, I can't, I mean, I have to use my, to summon it, I have to use one of my, pieces of gold dust.
I'm guessing you have some equal to your charisma or something to that effect?
Yeah, no, it's just 3 times, I think. Right?
If you wanted, maybe we could change it to your charisma modifier times. Because that would make sense. Instead of what it's currently at.
What is it currently at? 3?
Yeah, right now it's 3, because you start with 2, and then you gain 1 at 7.
Yeah, that's right.
And you, because you focused on charisma, I don't think it would be
a big deal. It'd be better for me.
Yeah, but also since you're not focusing strength, then you're kind of already
limiting its potential.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. So I'll say if you want, we can change it to charisma modifier times per short rest, and then we'll see how that goes.
That would be cool. Like, that would let me use it. That would let me use it more often in the exchange for it not being as powerful as it could be, right? Which is cool, right? Like, it's like the charisma doing something different than the strength build.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
Are you, by the way, are your short swords in that form? Are you swinging around great swords with that?
No, just I've got short swords, but they get a
They do bonus. Fire damage or something?
They get a 1d6 due to their size, and then I can change their type as a bonus action if I want. For a minute.
Ooh, to like anything?
I can switch it to just one. I have a one.
Yeah, he can
one
only
choice
switch it to
list.
Fire or yeah. Switch it back.
There might be something to pick to add more to that, but for now, I just kind of choose to fire or not.
it's pretty cool. I saw that armor, I was like, ooh, that looks sick. And then you're like, yeah, it's got a bunch of little abilities, you know, like little shield for Gelbin. That appreciated that. He liked it.
Of your gold dust.
Gold dust. Oh man, this is so awesome. So awesome. Yeah, so there's some really cool tricks. It was hard to pick ones, but I picked some pretty cool ones.
I like that shield.
I might not be like, cool. My character might not be like that powerful, but he's gonna be fun, and he's kind of built to be just a giant tank anyways. Which...
You're what we really need. You're front line very yeah. heavily.
That's what I am. I'm like gonna hit people, I'm gonna swing a lot of times at them too, and that's pretty much the plan, is just be a big target.
Yeah, and that was sick. I like that.
It was a good fight. I love how we got along.
Yeah, like I think we've all got pretty good abilities going. Like I'm good at killing the smaller things, and obviously Sniper over here is got that damage coming out.
Oh yeah,
he's got that, he can fix drive the vehicle, fix stuff.
Yeah, drive it.
He's very cool. Like he fills a lot. Our characters, we did not build them together, but they mesh very well. It's almost as if we did plan them this way.
We got like the main kind of like buddy cop deal here with our support robot friend in the back. See him off in the distance, a gleam, and then all of a sudden a sniper shot blows some dude's head off. Oh, there he is.
Good cop, bad cop.
Yeah, I do like that was going on there. The intimidation and the persuasion.
Well, I figure I'm going to be very all about the law, maybe too far. And you're going to have to pull me back, and then you're going to be too far away from the law, and I'm going to have to reel you in. I think that's going to be our dynamic, right? Yeah, so, like, you know, if we're in the gambling place, like, you're going to be all like, yeah, right? And like, all the, or whatever, maybe. Yes. Or if we get into really illegal activity and it's fun, like, you're going to embrace that, and I'm going to be like, I'm going to be the one that has to reel you in, whereas we're doing something like this, you have to reel me in.
It's not the chance. Yeah. It's not the risk.
The risk and reward, yes. I love that. Again, I love that's the name of your guns, man. It's so cool.
Well, Blake messaged me at the start of the game because I said something like, when I like got my guns, I'm like, hello, welcome home, babies, or something. And then he was like, do you have them named? I'm like, no. He's like, name them. I'm like, that's a great idea. So I'm like, I'm sitting here thinking, I'm like, what should I name them? I'm like, and it just kind of hit. I'm like, ooh, the gambler. Get the risk, you get the reward.
Get the risk.
Sometimes the best reward is the sweet embrace of death.
The misfire.
It's true.
You know, when I do the violent shot for Gunslinger, I think I'm always going to use risk. It's increasing the risk that it fucks up for more damage.
Makes sense.
So I think that's kind of a cool idea. It's funny too, because it was like when me and Alex were talking, it was like, really? Or like it was pretty much like I had crossbow expert and I don't have to reload. I don't really have any benefit for holding two guns, but like flavor wise I'm like, yeah, but it's cool, man. Also, they could misfire, and now it's like, and I have two names. They're my babies.
I like it. I like I think your characters so far, you've definitely shown your strengths.
Well, I've also shown that I need to not be nearly as close to things, because that hurt quite a bit. Now, to be fair, not quite as much as, you know, Mark's Death Angel hit last night against the Rock, but it was close.
It was only 88 damage in a single turn.
I gotta go.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, Mark, let me say,